let's go ahead and get started. So, in accordance with the Open Public Meetings Act, PL 1975, Chapter 231, adequate notice of this regular meeting of the Planning Board of the Township of Franklin has been provided. If everyone could please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Councilman Chase.
Here.
Mr. Houck.
Here.
Ms. Steinhauer. Mr. Guyver.
Here.
Mr. Mettler.
Here.
Mr. Onyaka is just arriving, so he's here. Mr. Pettit is still recovering, so he's excused. Mr. Thomas.
Here.
Mr. Ptasnak. Chairman Orsini.
Here. Let me just make a couple of administrative announcements. So, under resolutions, we're not going to do the planning board calendar yet. Not everything is set. And the executive session will be moved to the end because it didn't make sense to remove all of you from the room, have an executive session, or us go somewhere else and then and come back. So we're going to move it to the end. So with that, minutes, regular meeting October 21st.
Move to approve if there's no discussion.
Oh, there's one little thing.
There's a comma.
RISRA Corporation. In the second line, our transcriber heard Rishra as dishrag.
That's a good correction, Ted.
Oh, I think that ought to be fixed.
That's acceptable correction. Yeah. It could be autocorrect.
Rishra is not in the vocabulary of spell check.
That's why they probably changed it to dishrag.
With that correction, I move to approve.
Councilman Chase.
Yes.
Mr. Howe.
Yes.
MacGyver.
Here. Yes.
Mr. Mettler.
Yeah.
Mr. Onyaka.
Yes.
Mr. Thomas.
Yes.
Chairman Orsini.
Yes. And the regular meeting from November the 4th.
Move to approve.
Second.
Councilman Chase.
Yes.
Mr. Howe.
Yes.
Mr. MacGyver.
Yes.
Mr. Mettler.
Yes.
Mr. Onyaka.
Yes.
Mr. Thomas.
Yes.
Chairman Orsini.
Yes. So we have resolutions. M Affiliates LLC and Elkins Enterprises LLC, PLN 1500012.
Move to approve.
Councilman Chase.
Yes.
Mr. Howe.
Yes.
Mr. MacGyver.
Yes.
Mr. Mettler.
Yeah.
Mr. Onyaka.
Yes.
Mr. Thomas.
Yes.
Chairman Orsini.
Yes. SCAR, PLN 1500007.
Move to approve.
Second.
Councilman Chase.
Yes.
Mr. Houck.
Yes.
Mr. MacGyver.
Yes.
Mr. Mettler.
Yeah.
Mr. Onyaka.
Yes.
Mr. Thomas.
Yes.
Chairman Orsini.
Yes. And last but not least, the infamous RISRA Corporation, PLN 1500009.
Move to approve.
Second.
Councilman Chase.
Yes.
Mr. Houck.
Yes.
Mr. MacGyver.
Yes.
Mr. Mettler.
Yeah.
Mr. Onyaka.
Yes.
Mr. Thomas.
Yes.
Chairman Orsini.
Yes. Vouchers. Planning Board Attorney Peter Vignolo, December retainer, $833.33.
Move to approve.
Second.
Councilman Chase.
Yes.
Mr. Houck.
Yes.
Ms. MacGyver.
Yes.
Mr. Mettler.
Yes.
Mr. Onyaka.
Yes.
Mr. Thomas.
Yes.
Chairman Orsini.
Yes.
Thank you, guys.
Hasn't gone up yet, so that's good. First hearing, Canal Walk, PLN 1400013. So while Peter's getting set up, those of you who were here for the hearing a couple months ago should know the ground rules. When we open to the public, we'll limit to 2 or 3 minutes. Please make salient points related to the application. And factual, if you are seconding or in agreement with a previously made point, please keep it brief and emphasize that so we can get out of here at a reasonable hour. And Peter, for your part, I think, you know, we've gone through a lot of stuff, so I think just highlight changes and, you know, whatever compliance or disagreement, you know, if you're complying, you're complying. So just emphasize any points of discussion.
Actually, what I'm going to do is very briefly review the meeting of October 7th and tell you what we want to accomplish this evening, which is not to finish this evening because there are still some unresolved issues. First of all, for the record, Peter Landfritt, appearing on behalf of the applicant. In October, we presented to the board the amended GDP and asked for the approval, which the board has not yet acted on. But the amended GDP is actually in compliance with the general terms of the original GDP. The only amendment was the elimination of the commercial, the assisted living, and the congregate care where these new units are going to be constructed. That amended GDP met all requirements as to the breakdown of units, number of units, open space, and recreation. At that same meeting, we presented the testimony of Mr. Heibel, who reviewed the two parts, actually three parts to the project. The first part is the single-family houses that are located on the left side of the entrance of Canal Walk Boulevard, which is a subdivision application. The second part of the application was additional enclave units, 62 of them on the right side as you enter the subject property. And we reviewed them in general terms and also discussed the relocation of the guardhouse at the entrance. After that meeting, we took all of the staff comments and we have revised the subdivision plan for the 63 single families, which we are going to discuss tonight. And it shouldn't take a lot of discussion because we basically made most of the changes, if not all of the changes, that were requested by Township staff. We also, at the last meeting, did not have or present traffic testimony concerning the relocation of the guardhouse, and that's the testimony that I want to present this evening. We are not going to present anything on the enclave for two reasons. One reason is that we are still working out some redesigns based on staff comments. We just had a meeting last week with the DRCC. We just had a meeting with the township engineer the last few days. So that part of it has not been redesigned. But more importantly, you know, is that the entrance to that enclave section is right beyond the guardhouse. So we need to fix the location of the guardhouse before we can submit the plans for the enclave, because if the location of the guardhouse is not fixed, then everything else has to change. So I think that the presentation tonight will deal with the 63 single families and the guardhouse. Also, in reviewing the staff comments, there were a lot of comments from Mr. Healy and Mr. Vega concerning what Canal Walk Boulevard will look like with the reconfigured guardhouse. We have not at this juncture done all of the detailed landscaping, boulevards, and everything else, and didn't do it on purpose because until you fix the guardhouse, you can't do any of those things. Suffice it to say that if we fix the location this evening, when we come back with the enclave, we will then come back with a full redesigned Canal Walk Boulevard. And in a general sense that I will indicate in speaking to my client that the new Canal Walk Boulevard will have the same boulevards, the same trees, the same size, the same landscaping, and will be as good as it is now or better. But you'll get a chance to look at that. But we didn't design it until we can fix the location of the guardhouse. Having said that, I will call as my first witness, Mr. Heibel.
Mr. Heibel, you were sworn at the last meeting.
Yes.
You remain under oath. And just for the record, your credentials have not been detrimentally affected since last you appeared before this board and were qualified. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Heibel, you heard my opening remarks, and you're here this evening to discuss a couple of things. The first is the revisions to the plans that were made as a result of the public input and also the staff reports that were generated in September of 2015. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. As a result of those reports, you prepared revised plans, submitted them to the staff, and we received new staff reports, correct?
True.
Okay. Can we, well, we first of all should mark the exhibits that you're going to testify on. Now I'm trying to remember what the last exhibit. Mr. Vignolo, do you remember what the last exhibit was?
I don't. Let's do this. Let's call it B1.
That's fine.
How's that? If you could mark it with today's date as well. Today's the 16th of December. Mr. Lanford, are we marking B1 and B2?
I am marking B1 and B2. I will have Mr. Heibel identify them before he goes to those exhibits. The other thing before he starts, Mr. Orsini, and I think in order to move this along, Mr. Heibel's testimony won't be that long, and then I think it probably would make sense, rather than the board ask questions of Mr. Heibel, that I bring Mr. Dean up, who's the traffic consultant, because his testimony ties into Mr. Heibel's. Let him deal with the issues, and then they'll both be available to answer board questions and public questions. And I think it would make the evening move a little bit quicker, if that's okay with you.
Sounds good.
All right. Mr. Heibel, I have marked B1. Can you tell the board what B1 is?
B1 is Canal Walk 3, which is a site exhibit. It's a composite of the plans that are part of the 14 sheets that we submitted, which includes the layout of the 63 single families and the proposed landscaping in the streets, etc.
Okay. With respect to B1, can you indicate to the board what changes were made to B1 since we were last here?
Yes, there was the report from Mr. Vega, the engineering report. There were some internal storm drainage revisions that were made. His office has subsequently reviewed those. The applicant also, we provided a 4 to 6 foot high berm, both along Mettler's Lane and along Schoolhouse Road. We looked at the landscaping plans for the remainder of Mettler's Lane that was approved in the other sections. We revised the landscaping in keeping with the design that was already incorporated. Other than that, there were some small internal revisions, some minor sanitary sewer revisions. The plans were resubmitted to the sewage authority and the township, and we got reports from the township engineer, the township planner, and a new report from the sewage authority.
Okay. And in submitting the plans and the revised plans, can you indicate to the board what the treatment was at the intersection of Canal Walk and Boulevard and the new road that we are proposing to that section?
Yes, there was previously a landscaped island within that area. We actually pulled out some of the island with some striping. We had a meeting yesterday morning in the engineer's office. There was a left turn lane that was at that point proposed in that location. There is no need for that left-hand lane. So what we've done is we've increased the size of the landscaped island. It's actually shown on this plan. So this now meets the RSIA standards. The landscape island is back. It starts at Canal Walk Boulevard and goes all the way to the pedestrian crosswalk. So the entrance has two 14-foot wide lanes on both sides of the landscaped island. And Mr. Dean will clarify that it does meet the RSIA standards.
Okay. And also the way those lanes are set up, there's adequate room for emergency vehicles and fire trucks to access and exit that section
of
the
project. Yes, absolutely.
Okay. In conjunction with the revised plans, as usual, we get new staff reports.
Yes, we do.
Okay, and one of them is from Mr. Vega, dated December 8th, 2015. You discussed one of the changes that you have made as a result of the meeting with him yesterday. In reviewing his report, which consists of 13 pages, can we comply with all of the requested changes within that report?
Yes, I've reviewed it. Actually, when we say it's 13 pages, what he does is, and this is not a criticism, just as a matter of fact, he repeats the former comments, and if we've satisfied those comments, he indicates that in the report. So the report looks more voluminous than it is. There's some small comments regarding some easements on the final plat, et cetera. I've spoken personally to Mr. Vega. We will comply with each and every comment in that report.
Okay, and making those minor changes doesn't in any way alter what the board is looking at this evening. They're just technical changes for the most part.
Yes, as I previously said, the only change of any substance was the island that got reconfigured pursuant to yesterday's meeting.
Okay. You've also had an opportunity to review a report from Mr. Healy dated December 10th, 2015. And with, first of all, his report deals both with the 63 units there, plus it also deals with Canal Walk Boulevard, and we'll deal with that separately. But with respect to any comments raised by Mr. Healy in his report concerning the 63 units, do you have any issue with any of his comments?
No, just a qualification. There was a request by Mr. Healy to actually extend the sidewalk along the easterly side of Canal Walk Boulevard southerly. There's an existing sidewalk on the opposite side, on the westerly side, so it's the applicant's intent to put a pedestrian crosswalk and allow the public to actually cross Canal Walk Boulevard at that location and then onto the sidewalk that's already constructed.
Okay. Were there any reasons why you chose not to extend the sidewalk on the opposite side of the street?
Several. There are existing townhouses that are on the easterly side that are fairly close to the road, and extending the sidewalk would be fairly close to the back of those townhouses. I think those townhouses are as close as perhaps 25 to 30 feet from the right-of-way line.
Okay. Would it also involve having to remove and or relocate additional trees if that sidewalk were to be constructed?
Yes, yes.
And are there also utilities in that area that may be affected?
That is my understanding, although I did not do the engineering of that section.
Okay, thank you. Now, your next exhibit, which is B2, can you go to that exhibit and indicate to the board what that exhibit is?
That is an exhibit that I put together. That is the proposed relocated guardhouse that actually is also shown on B1, but I enlarged it for the purpose of Mr. Dean's presentation this evening. So there is no difference to the enlarged guardhouse than it appears on B1.
Okay, and just for orientation purposes, and then we'll call Mr. Dean up, can you indicate to the board where Schoolhouse Road is, what is being proposed in general terms, and then we'll have Mr. Dean deal with that exhibit in more detail.
Yes, Schoolhouse Road is on the top of the board. This is the entrance, proposed entrance to the enclave, although that's not for discussion this evening. I did show the proposed entrance, and this is the reconfiguration of the all the lanes that Mr. Dean will now discuss.
Okay, and in essence, there are two lanes in and one lane out of the subject property, correct?
True.
Okay, thank you. I have no further questions of Mr. Heibel. Is it this time if we can move on to Mr. Dean?
Good evening.
Good evening. If you, I wasn't at the last hearing, so he's new this evening, right?
This is the first time he's ever testified.
That's what I thought. If you could raise your right hand for me, do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
If you could state your name, spell your last name for the record, and provide your professional address.
Gary Dean, D-E-A-N. Professional address is 792 Chimney Rock Road in Martinsville, New Jersey.
Mr. Dean, can you briefly give the board the benefit of your educational and professional background?
Certainly. I've appeared numerous times before this board over the past 30 years, but I'm a licensed civil engineer, graduate of Lehigh University, and actively practicing in the field of traffic engineering and municipal consulting for traffic-related matters.
Okay.
He's accepted. It was good for him to say that, just so everybody knows, though.
Okay. And Mr. Dean, your firm and you in particular were involved in doing the traffic studies way back in the 1990s when this project first came out of the ground. Is that correct?
Yes. My first involvement with Canal Walk was 1998, and it involved the design of the traffic signals along Mettler's Lane and at Schoolhouse Road and Weston Canal Road. And since that time, we've been representing the applicant through the various phases, not only for Canal Walk, but Summerfields and a number of other projects in the area.
Okay. And you are familiar with all of the roads within the confines of the Canal Walk and also, obviously, all of the surrounding roads, both Weston, Mettler's, and Schoolhouse, correct?
I'm familiar with the roads. I haven't studied the internal roads as they've been constructed and occupied, but in terms of the primary means of ingress and egress to Schoolhouse, absolutely.
Okay. And at the last meeting, you were advised that there were some concerns about the relocation of the guardhouse and that there were members of the public that were concerned whether there was adequate stacking, whether it was too close to Schoolhouse Road. And were you asked by the applicant to do an analysis of the guardhouse?
Well, stepping back actually a little bit earlier than that concern, I was asked by the applicant during the inception of this project to revisit the entire guardhouse issue, recognizing that as Canal Walk has matured, there have been concerns raised about the design of the guardhouse, how it functions, particularly the difference between visitor traffic and residential traffic. So part of my responsibility with this project is to assist Mr. Heibel and the applicant in designing what you now see before you on, is that B2? Thank you. And so I'll accept either praise or criticism as appropriate for this design, but I have spent probably the better part of a year developing at least 6 or 7 different concepts, and I won't bore you with each one of those, but we've evaluated the proximity to Schoolhouse. We've evaluated the distance to the proposed enclave driveway. Working with Mr. Heibel, the enclave driveway has actually been moved further into the site interior than originally proposed so as to provide more stacking at the guardhouse to Schoolhouse Lane. And then we also wanted to ensure that we had the same means of U-turn provisions as exist today should a visitor not be permitted entry into the community or does so errantly. And that's the bubble, if you will, to the right-hand side of the exhibit. And also segregating visitor and residential traffic, recognizing that visitors need to be admitted and converse typically with the guard within the booth, whereas residents have effectively a clear right of way to come into the community. So with that background and recognizing the concerns since the project's inception, members of my staff, as well as I, have visited the site on numerous occasions over the past several months to observe queuing, stacking at the guardhouse. And as the board may be aware, currently the guardhouse does not have a restroom within the structure itself. And there have been periods where the attendant leaves the guardhouse unattended, goes to the clubhouse, takes care of what they need to take care of, and returns. And in that interim period, not always is the gate left up. In fact, it's been closed. And you can imagine what might occur with service vehicles, furniture deliveries, and the like, with effectively a guard booth that's not been attended, is that, yes, queuing has occurred. Since that time, and recognizing the focus that this application has given these proceedings, I thought it would be extremely beneficial to not just observe stacking on a random day or take some video. And at my request, I asked the applicant to install a video camera, a webcam, within the guard booth itself, so that on a 24/7 basis, we could, members of my firm as well as the applicant, could routinely and regularly observe queuing at the guardhouse. And that camera was installed, I believe, at the end of October. It still exists today, and I have several photographs that I'd like to share with you that represent my personal observations of what I call the worst-case queuing or stacking on a given day during a given hour. And I probably have maybe 10 such photographs. They're by example. I don't have to introduce every one, but however you wish to proceed.
Well, if you want... Mr. Lanford, it's your application.
Why don't we mark them as C1 through 10, I guess, and then, you know, if he wants to refer to a specific one, and we'll do
sounds good to me.
So what I've depicted on the easel is the perspective and the photograph from the actual camera installation. And what you will see is stacking. With a vehicle just to the very lower left-hand corner of the exhibit, and then the additional vehicles that queue or stack behind that vehicle. Fortunately, what I've done is screen capture, as it's known, each of these video presentations, and it has the date and the time of each observation. I will note for the record that as we flip through these, because of daylight savings time, the hour is actually 1 hour ahead. But it's not particularly significant, but I did want to bring that to your attention. And so in the first exhibit, you'll see what I consider to be a typical maximum or peak queue of four vehicles. There is a vehicle, as I've indicated, in the lower left-hand corner who's conversing with the guard, and then three other vehicles behind that first individual. And this particular example occurred on November 10th. At 2015 at 10:25 in the morning. A day later, and again, this is just a typical example. This is a larger, it appears to be perhaps a move-in or move-out type van, the Penske rental. And behind it appears to be either a landscape or some other maintenance type vehicle, a two-car queue. But I did felt that this was appropriate just in that we did occasionally see a truck enter. On the 12th, the next day at 12:21 p.m., a three-vehicle queue, again a van, a service van, a passenger vehicle behind it, and then a larger truck conversing with the guard. On the December 4th at 10:15 in the morning, again, three vehicles. And I'm not taking pictures of when it's empty, but I would represent that that's 99% of the time is that there's one or two vehicles or no vehicles at the guard booth. You'll see the weather is favorable, sunny days on most of these. And I've captured representative again on the 4th, 10:13 in the morning, two service vehicles. And then I thought this one was important only because a minute later, this is later in the day, there was the, I believe it's the county shuttle van, a contractor, a tile contractor, and then two vehicles behind the shuttle van, again, for a total of four. And four consistently is the maximum number over now 6 or 7 weeks of observations, plus a month of observations prior when we were photographing and taking video ourselves without the webcam, that I would submit that these are representative of typical conditions throughout morning, afternoon, and evening hours at the guard booth. Here we are on the 14th, just this week, Again, three vehicles. Here we had four at 1226 this, I think it was Monday, one of which was a service vehicle, two passenger cars directly behind that vehicle. And you may ask, all right, you're showing us static pictures of stacking. How long does this last? It's generally under a minute. And the reason is many of the regular visitor contractor vehicles are on a list. They're familiar to the guard, and they're simply waved through. They don't have to stop and converse. So obviously, those known vehicles are processed much more efficiently. And what I wanted to show on the last two photographs, this is from 12-2 at roughly 3 in the afternoon. This is what I spent most of my time seeing, which is nothing. No vehicles. There is one. There is one resident vehicle you'll see on the far right-hand side of the exhibit, but that's typically the case. And then even as late as tonight, just so you could see, it monitors into the evening hours. So we have the ability to constantly, and we have been monitoring the traffic flow. This is important because in the design that we schematically developed and Mr. Heibel's office engineered, we can provide stacking of 7 to 8 vehicles all the way out before that ninth vehicle would extend and impede traffic on Schoolhouse. So we've provided double the capacity to get that visitor traffic. Should that ever exceed our expectations on queuing and experience, We have what we believe is enough of a margin of safety for this relocated design. You'll also see a few other features that I'd like to describe because they are important. We spent some time considering the location, and you'll see in a black bar at the, I'll call it the southerly end of the guardhouse island, a black bar that represents the gate. That would be the mechanism that allows that traffic to enter. We spent some time evaluating whether that gate would be better served on the following island or reversing the residential gate. And some of the concerns that were expressed, we had some preliminary meetings with the residents, is the concern that if the visitor's gate was located deeper into the site, by the time they are processed, and we do have a merge condition so that we provide a single lane coming in the balance of Canal Walk Boulevard, they might not be able to see the resident who is allowed passage. So we felt that having that control directly at both gates would provide a clear line of sight for the visitors of any approaching residential traffic. Nevertheless, there were some additional concerns expressed about this merge condition. And so, again, working with the applicant, what is proposed as part of this system is what's called a gate interlock. It's a simple relay in that only one gate can open at a time. So that ensures only one vehicle will be passing. And if the residents use their actuator and open the gate, then the visitors can't proceed. So we have an added margin of safety to ensure that this merge condition occurs at a slow rate of speed and is very controlled. Our other charge and our final charge was to ensure, and we did look at bringing the entire guard system closer to the proposed enclave entrance. And the concern was that future residents might feel as though this entire process is sitting right on top of them, that it might be either intimidating or create some sight distance concerns that could affect their ability to turn left and go out to Schoolhouse. So we struck a balance between providing adequate visibility and lines of sight for that future exiting traffic with the need for stacking away from Schoolhouse. And over 6-7 different iterations, we finally developed the scheme you have before you. We've added signing and striping. Police during the process have weighed in with their concerns. We do have some supplemental signs to denote a visitor's lane and a residence lane. That'll be very conspicuous at the end of the island. And the whole intent is to keep traffic slow and managed as it comes into the community, as it should be. That's
all right, couple,
the essence of the guard all discussion.
All right, a couple quick questions. Obviously, the application, which is not being discussed this evening, is the enclave and the 62 units there. Do you have a projection or idea of how much traffic would be generated out of there and what impact that traffic may have on the guardhouse?
I do, and our primary concern, as I indicated, was to provide a significant separation between those two components. The way we developed our projections for the new enclave is that over the many years, we've had the opportunity to conduct counts at Canal Walk Boulevard, identify the traffic that's using the access, and then correlate that to the number of units that have been sold and occupied. So we have then taken that data and applied it to the enclave to create a forecast. And the volumes are quite low. I think it's around 12 or 15 vehicles per hour, which is about one person leaving every 5 minutes. And with only 62 units in the enclave, that's the typical frequency that we've seen from the balance of the community. And we would expect that same pattern to continue with the enclave.
Okay. The other question that was raised at the hearing in October, as you enter the site from schoolhouse, there is a grade going down toward where this guardhouse is. And did either you or Mr. Heibel look at the grade as far as stopping at distances and any concerns about any grade issues at that point?
I have. Obviously, it's not level. It's not flat. There is a very, very modest grade. I don't recall what it is off the top of my head, but that was considered in our evaluation. Obviously, asking people to stop on a very steep incline is not really sound engineering practice. But in terms of the very gradual nature of the initial part of Canal Walk as it transitions from schoolhouse into the community, I felt very comfortable that this extremely modest grade is not an issue, even in inclement weather, for vehicles to be able to safely negotiate the proposed location.
Okay. In addition, I assume you're familiar with the existing guardhouse.
Yes.
And that guardhouse in and of itself has some problems, does it not?
It does.
And can you indicate what those problems are and how and they are being alleviated by this relocation?
As I've indicated, just the size of the guardhouse, the absence of restroom facilities, and has yielded some inherent constraints and operational problems. In addition, the applicant has gone through a number of different gate designs, and I believe it's at a point of functioning reasonably well now, although mechanically the resident gate, we did observe several times during our monitoring where the guard, and you can see the traffic cones on the exhibit, the guard would occasionally have to close the residential gate because it wasn't working, meaning all traffic came through the visitor's gate. And even under that type of loading, we never saw bigger than a four-car queue. So I feel very confident that our design is appropriate. The other constraint with the existing guard house operation is currently, and it's tough to see on the exhibit, but you'll perhaps can see that residents now are required to in essence bubble out from the visitor's lane, which is the straight approach. And then immediately after the gate, those residents are in essence forced into a hard left merge to come back into the community. And I describe it as fairly constrained. Larger vehicles, anyone who's traveling, perhaps a little too fast, sometimes the curb gets hit. And under this design, what you'll note is that I've designed it to eliminate that bump out that exists today and give the residents clear and direct access into the community, and that the visitors, in essence, bump out and then once allowed entry, then merge back into the residential lane. And the reason is, looking at the percentage of traffic, it's on the order of 90%, 10%, or 95%, 5%. Why should the residents be disadvantaged with the sort of taper departure and then merge? I felt that they should have priority in terms of entering their own community. So that was one of the other design elements of this, and that's why you'll see somewhat exaggerated. It's a very straight alignment coming in, but the outbound alignment features what I'll call the bulb, and that's the cul-de-sac for, or the reverse turn for U-turns, but it allows that visitor traffic to be directed in and controlled better.
Okay. Lastly, you're aware, and I made the statement in my opening remarks, that the original GDP, which is a concept plan, had the development on either side of the entrance as being on the left side a shopping center and on the right side assisted living and congregate care facilities. Can you opine as to the benefits of now putting residential units, which are, the applicant is entitled to, at the entrance and eliminating those types of uses?
There are two parts to my answer. The first is, and I wasn't part of the original GDP approval, but my understanding is that it was approved for 1,260 units, 40,000, 45,000 square feet of commercial space, and 240, I believe, assisted or congregate care units. With the subject application for the single family homes and with the proposed enclave units, the total will be 1,252. So the total number of units overall is less than was approved for the GDP. But more importantly, the elimination of the commercial space yields, and we submitted an analysis, substantially less traffic than age-restricted dwelling units, to the tune of upwards of 100-plus vehicles per hour. Less traffic associated with this change in use. And then we haven't discussed it yet, but as part of the enclave, it's a similar finding. With 220 assisted living units, there would obviously have been employee traffic. All of that is eliminated. And so instead of 100 vehicles per hour, it's 12 or 15. So both of these applications represent a substantial decrease in overall traffic.
Okay, and lastly, just for the record, you heard Mr. Heibel talk as to Exhibit B1 and the change that we made at the entrance to the 63 single-family units, and it's on the ground there. And this was part of a discussion we had yesterday with the township staff, and for the record, the entrance that we now have, does it in fact meet with the RSIS standards?
In my opinion, the entire subdivision now conforms with the residential site improvement standards, and for the public's benefit, it is essentially the regulations as related to the development of homes in New Jersey. RSIS sets forth the required standards for width of streets and how much curvature a road can have and the location of sidewalks. One of those elements contained within RSIS is a limitation of the number of units on a, what we'll call a cul-de-sac or a street with a single means of ingress and egress. And the principal concern with that is once a certain critical mass is achieved, if a safety incident occurs, that emergency personnel have a secondary means to get into the community. And the way that's effectuated is with a boulevard design. So that if there was a motor vehicle accident or some type of incident blocking one side of the boulevard, that EMTs, fire, et cetera, have the ability to drive on the other side of the boulevard as though it's a second means of ingress and egress to access the balance of the community. With a loop road, that boulevard needs to be extended to the first intersection, which it has been done. So with the revised design, two things have happened. One, we meet RSIS, but secondly, we address the concerns that were in the staff reports with the original boulevard and median design, which had a little kink in it, for lack of a better word, and police and engineering staff wanted this entrance basically smoothed out. So we've accomplished that.
Thank you, Mr. Dean. I have no further questions.
Entertain questions from the board for either witness. Carl?
This is for the engineer. The proposed guardhouse has a water main underneath it. I think the water main would need to be relocated to the roadway area.
Yes, it would.
Okay. There are two other instances on the subdivided site in front of lots 3 and 4 and lots 33 and 34 where you have the water mains basically underneath the walking paths or sidewalks. Those would need to be relocated to the roadway area.
Okay,
I think
that
it could
be
accommodated by shifting the sanitary sewer.
Yes.
Okay. One other comment which was added to these sets of plans. Between lot 12 and 13, what is the distance between the houses? Sorry, where the water main goes out to schoolhouse.
Between 12 and 13, I'm scaling it. I get approximately 20 feet, so it must be 20 feet.
Okay. I think as far as creating that looped area there for the water main, I think it would be more beneficial for any kind of future maintenance for the water department to relocate it somewhere between lot 23 and 24 where you have additional area to be able to get in there rather than, you know, ripping out flower beds which would be adjacent to a house.
We can do that. We actually added that water line in and I met with the Mr. Houck and he said at any location. He generally pointed to there and I put it where he pointed, but I understand your concern and the applicant will do that.
And of course you'll need a utility easement.
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
Any other questions from the board? Ted?
I'm sure you think you've answered this question, but I wonder, again, going back to John House's comment, the intersection of Canal Walk Boulevard and the proposed road need to be evaluated for adequate aerial fire truck access. Both roads have concrete islands at the intersection that appear to make turning in and out of the proposed road difficult. Are you sure? Have you run it with a model truck on the plan to be sure that you...
Yes, actually that was one of his earlier comments when we met. One of them was satisfactory. The other one, we actually had to modify the curb to meet his requirements. So we've done that and we've agreed to do that. That's actually why we, Mr. Dean recommended originally that we take the island away and we use the striping, but then we didn't comply with the RSIS. So what we've done is we've straightened out the road. We now comply with the RSIS and provide the turning radii necessary for the fire truck.
What is it that the RSIS is requiring at this point?
That's what Mr. Dean just spoke about.
It has to do with the number of units that can be served on a cul-de-sac or a road with only one ingress and egress. And
so
in
having an island, you're making two roads.
Correct. A boulevard up to the first intersection addresses that concern under RSIS.
I have my doubts. We can't violate RSIS.
Anything from this end? Bob?
For Mr. Dean, when you were talking about the reduction in traffic because there would not be the commercial on the, I guess it would be the left side going in, that presupposes no connection, no road connection between the commercial and the boulevard, because as originally designed, I think that was only going to have a pedestrian connection to the rest of Canal Walk from the commercial. So that testimony would have to do then more with people going from Canal Walk, driving out, going to the stores, then driving back. Is that what you're saying?
I looked at it from a little bit further out perspective, and as traffic engineers do, we tend to look at it on the macro sense. In other words, in terms of net effect on the community, that includes residents both within Canal Walk and external to Canal Walk. Mm-hmm. So the net traffic difference is, as I've indicated, and I did submit a report just for identification purposes. I think it was when the GDP was amended. It was from June of 2014. But it shows that there would be a decrease in the evening peak hour of at least 118 vehicles. Mm-hmm. So I don't have the background to know whether the board or the developer envisioned a vehicular connection either inside the gate or outside the gate, so that residents from the more remote parts of the community could directly access the commercial component without having to exit onto Schoolhouse. I don't know.
That wasn't the original design, to have such a connection.
As I said, I don't know, and I don't have the background on that, but I can indicate that in terms of global impact, and particularly at Schoolhouse and Canal Walk Boulevard, a reduction in traffic is, in my opinion, an absolutely beneficial element, and it's fairly rare. I mean, I'm usually here to talk about why there's more traffic and that it's okay. In this case, we have an opportunity to reduce it, which is fairly infrequent.
Okay.
Mr. Heibel, have you added more fire hydrants in compliance with John House's recommendation?
Yes, at the meeting that we originally had with Mr. Houck, I asked where, and he actually drew them on the plan, and then I put them exactly where he wanted them.
Ted?
Oh, I'd just like to say, in response to what Mr. Dean just said, it was always my concept, but perhaps not Mr. Hiller's concept, that the stores there would have entrances from both sides so that Canal Walk residents could park still within the guardhouse and a parking lot on the inside of the stores and access the stores without going out. But since apparently Mr. Hiller has decided that it's more remunerative to build more houses than to build stores there, we're being presented with a present plan, so now residents of Canal Walk will have to go out of Canal Walk and drive over either to the new stores at Summerfields or to Elizabeth Avenue to go to a store. So you're getting the traffic that way.
Questions, Mr. Chairman?
Mark, go ahead.
Two for Mr. Heibel. With regard to the berming on Mettler's, you had said that the proposed berm is 3 to 4 feet in height.
4 to 6, I believe,
four
Mark.
4 to 6.
Yes.
Okay, sorry. And how does that, do you happen to know what the height of the existing berm is?
I believe it's approximately the same height. It varies. It's mostly 5 to 6, I would say.
You're saying that when the berm goes in the north, this subdivision is going to be of the same height.
Yes, that is what I'm saying.
And could you explain how are construction vehicles going to enter this site? What's construction movement?
There's an existing construction entrance. I believe that they'll use that entrance. They come in off of Canal Boulevard, and there's actually a construction entrance. It's not shown on the final plan, but they will utilize that. So they'll come in Canal Walk Boulevard, and then they'll go on the driveway that's on the property right now.
You mean before the guardhouse?
Yes, before the guardhouse. Excuse me. Yes.
A few questions for Mr. Dean. In the photos, well, first of all, could you go to B2? So you're showing two lanes in up to Schoolhouse. What are the width of those lanes?
I did neglect to mention that, so thank you for raising it, because one of the original concepts kept Canal Walk Boulevard as it is today with a single entry lane, and in an effort to, again, address the concerns about stacking, the island and curb line was modified for the residents' benefits to create two full lanes coming in. The inner lane next to the landscaped island, the visitor's lane, if you will, is proposed at 11 feet, and then the adjacent lane for residents would be 12 feet.
Okay, and the lane striping and the pavement markings that you're showing on there, are those actually proposed to be painted on the surface? Or are those conceptual just for this board?
I will say whatever the board's preference. My recommendation would be that they are, in fact, painted. One caveat is aesthetics, and some people may feel it's a really good idea to have that measure of control. Others may feel, well, that's not really the entry statement we want for our community. What we have proposed are pavement markings that clearly denote the lanes for residents and for visitors, and I would recommend that regardless. But in terms of the center line striping, it can be added at any time. We showed it on the plan, I'd say, for informational purposes as opposed to a construction note 4-inch white line.
Okay.
But whatever the board's pleasure, we're happy to comply.
And then what's the distance from the guardhouse where the car would be pulled up to the guardhouse to Schoolhouse?
170 feet.
170 feet. And
correct.
How many cars did you say that would accommodate?
8, depending on the aptitude of the driver and the size. Obviously, if there's a large moving van, as we saw in one of those pictures, that number might go down to 7.
Okay.
I wouldn't imagine a continuous line of moving vans, but as we've seen, it does seem to consistently be a mixture of maybe one or two service vehicles and then passenger cars.
Okay. And how much, so doing the math, that assumes how much space per car?
Roughly 20.
20, okay.
And just so everyone's aware, I mean, a standard, say, a Ford Explorer is 16 feet.
Okay.
So that leaves plenty of generous room from rear bumper to front bumper. Compact, you know, Camrys and the like are obviously much shorter.
Okay. Can you bring up one of the photos?
Of course.
Of the queuing?
I'm sorry, my exhibit fell apart, so I'll... Is the one that's displayed?
I think that one proves, maybe two illustrates two questions that I have. One is, did you observe that when people were queuing, that they were observing that 20-foot sequencing of queuing, for lack of a better term?
I'll say yes, with one exception, and I think it's the shuttle van in one of the pictures. He seemed to have a good 10 to 12 feet to the next vehicle. I'm not sure why. Maybe he was thinking he could get waved into the residence lane.
Okay.
But by and large, and we spend a fair amount of time measuring queuing at traffic signals because it's a capacity issue. And we find that that's a very reasonable measurement given the varied size of cars.
So, and the reason I'm asking is, we all know there's one thing where something that says something in a book versus what actually happens in real practice. So based on what you observed from the videos and the screen captures, you observed that roughly that 20 foot was
correct
observed for most of the time.
And I will say, if I were to go to the book actually says 25. I just never see that in the field.
Okay. And then this photo also illustrates my question, which is, at what point, how many cars deep does the queuing go before you start to block the resident lane. So it looks like maybe after the third or fourth car, maybe it starts to get blocked?
That's correct. And here you have three vehicles. A resident can get by this van. You'll see he's not exactly up to the curb. And it depends on the next vehicle. If it's a passenger car and they're closer to, I'm pointing, but if they're closer to the median, in other words, they're more to the left of the entry road, then a resident can bypass. But if they're not as diligent, and that's why striping obviously adds a measure of guidance, that can help. But this is clearly what's being remedied under the proposed. Okay,
so that's showing a truck, which obviously is longer, and that truck isn't all the way over to the left.
Correct.
But if everybody was, if there were passenger cars and if they were over to the left, at what point do they get blocked? Is it four or five cars?
I would say yes, in that range.
Okay. You're talking about the existing condition.
Yes.
Correct.
Obviously, because with the new condition, that's eliminated.
Existing versus the proposed. Yeah. Okay. All right, that's all my questions. Thank you.
Ted?
I'm sorry to keep returning. I wanted to refer to the diagram that you have there. I forget what exhibit that is, but it shows the space between the visitor's lane and the exit lane where I assume someone is to turn around if they're not going to proceed further. But your gate is before that, so that would require that the guard raise the gate even if the person is not supposed to be proceeding further?
Correct.
And what happens if he proceeds further anyway?
Then it's a matter of calling security.
I was just thinking if you could have a gate controlled by the guardhouse that is beyond that point where you have two islands that you can put it between.
I think I explained that was one of our design options, and the concern was that the visitor, because of the staggering between the residence gate and the visitor's gate, that visitor wouldn't be able to see because it's then behind him on his right shoulder, so in essence on the blind side of the vehicle, he would not be able to discern that a resident was coming through.
Well, you still have a fair amount of island beyond there.
I will say it seems to be one of those polarizing concerns. The applicant at this point, we're amenable to move it, but we've gone through this with police, staff, fire, the applicant. We've had a presentation to the residents, and it was felt for the highest level of control and visibility, having those two gates in the same plane was preferred.
Well, as long as all persons are obedient in turning around when they're supposed to turn around, yes, but perhaps we'll hear from the residents on this subject.
Bob?
Just one more question and a little bit of concern that you do have the two lanes merging just before the entrance to the enclave. And are you fairly confident that no visitor is going to cut in front of a resident to get into that entrance?
Under the proposed design, I am.
Yeah.
And the reason is because of the gate interlock, only one vehicle at a time can be admitted. And so should a visitor have the enclave as a destination, that visitor will be permitted entry and the residential gate will be down so that will allow him the ability to make that turn. We did consider that, and that's, again, part of keeping those two gates in the same plane, including the interlock. I suspect the visitor traffic into the enclave will be fairly light, but again, we wanted to have the highest degree of safety. And that's why that recommendation was developed.
Anyone else?
I'm sorry, I have one more comment, but this is for Mr. Heibel, and it's just something we often talk about at the Environmental Commission. you have your street trees, you have blocks of, say, runs of, say, five of a given species. There's a certain concern that if one species should fall prey to some disease, that then you'd have a whole stretch of dead trees, and it might be better to mix up the trees more instead of having all one species for a stretch of five on each side.
We could rotate some of the trees. Would there be a maximum in your recommendation to have in a row, like three maybe?
No.
Yes, so the applicant would agree to that.
Same trees, same number, just
yes, I understand.
Slightly
yes.
Differently arranged.
Okay, if there are no more comments from the board, I'll entertain a motion to open to the public.
I move to open to the public.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Members of the public are free to come up. Microphone should be on. Let's give your name and address and swear in.
My name is Leon Krals, K-R-A-L-S, 14 okay. Patriots Way in Somerset. I'm speaking tonight as a member of the Canal Walk Homeowners Association. I do have a number of questions regarding the plans. I do have
Excuse me,
if I could swear you in real quick.
I'm sorry.
If you could raise your right hand, do you swear
the testimony? I was sworn in the last time, but okay.
Do real quick. Do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you. I did have several questions. One of them is a procedural question because the agenda tonight talked about the 63 houses. The gatehouse is not part of the 63 houses. So therefore, a number of people that were concerned about that were understood that that was not going to be discussed tonight. So I do have a procedural question as to whether or not we should even be discussing this because it's not part of the 63 houses. I would present that to the board as a question.
Well, the application that was submitted included this. So what's on the agenda versus what the application? So what's before the board tonight is Mr. Lanford, and I think he can repeat it, what he's asking for tonight is appropriate, and the board has jurisdiction to hear it.
Okay, well, the reason I asked the question is because I've seen the plans for the 63 houses. The gatehouse was not mentioned on any of those blueprints.
The original application dealt with, obviously, the enclave, the gatehouse, and the 63. That was the notice. That's what we presented in October. We came back this evening, and there was no new notice requirement, so we're still here under the original notice to discuss the 63 and the location of the guardhouse or the gatehouse. As I indicated in my opening, if the location can be fixed, we will then be back with the enclave, with the full design of the gatehouse, the boulevard, and again, if people thought that it wasn't going to be discussed, they will have an opportunity at that time to make comment because we will be back here again to discuss the gatehouse.
Okay. Thank you. I did have some questions from Mr. Dean. A couple of different ones. I'm going to have to go back and forth because you show a photograph here of, I believe that's two vehicles plus a truck. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay.
Well, three vehicles.
Three vehicles plus a truck.
No, a truck is a vehicle.
Okay, three vehicles total. Well, it's important because the truck is important because if you look at the back of the truck where it is located on that particular sketch, it's somewhat difficult. I know the audience cannot see that. Back of the truck is actually about, it's halfway into that, the intersection, the turnaround intersection there. Oh, this is the turnaround section right here. I'm talking about the
existing. You can take the mic out if it's more convenient. Just take it out so we can hear you.
The public can't see this, but my question is, what is the distance from the existing window of the gatehouse, not the gate, but the window of the gatehouse to the back of that particular truck?
Feel free to put that on the easel if you think that's easier to show everybody. Thank you.
I don't know the answer to that.
That's critical because I believe that's about 85 feet. So then I would have to go and superimpose it on here and say, where is 85 feet here? because I believe that 85 feet would in fact block the resident access to this particular roadway. So that's a key element here, because without seeing actual vehicles on here, this photograph is somewhat misleading. Because again, this here, now I have photographs, and I don't believe I can introduce these, but I'll try. This is one, this happened to be on July 31st, 2015, 8:32 a.m. Five vehicles lined up at the existing gatehouse. And I just happened to be riding by on my bicycle and took a picture for a totally unrelated reason. And this clearly showed that they were blocking the resident access at that particular time. And I believe the same thing would happen here. My sketch is, I went off the plans that were submitted. I don't know if I can submit this or not, but my sketch shows that two vehicles and a truck would in fact block the, with the new design, would actually would block the residents' access. I don't know if I can submit this or not.
If we could, yep, we can take the initial picture. We'll mark D1, and if you can, if you want to bring those up, I'll mark them.
Sure.
Is D1 and D2?
We'll mark those.
Unfortunately, I only brought one because I didn't think we were discussing this tonight.
Okay. And this would be D2.
Should be R2-D2. Star Wars.
Yeah, that is definitely.
Why don't you show those to Peter and his team first? And
sure. And the reason for the photo D1 is because of the spacing, that it shows that in this particular, and this happens to be a Google Maps picture showing three vehicles at the gate and at the existing gate, and it could have been purely magical that at that particular day there were three when you said there really aren't all that many, but I think there are. Now, this particular photograph shows five vehicles, and I measured it out, 125 feet clearly blocks the existing and then some. Over here, I believe that the exact same situation would happen here. This photograph, to me, tells me that two cars and a truck would block the residents' access. And I believe that those vehicles and that truck are to scale. So this would contradict what Mr. Dean is saying.
As we've explained, there have been instances where under the current design, there are problems. Those are the exact design constraints that we're seeking to remedy with this application. So in terms of the do-nothing alternative, I think that's inferior for the residents. In terms of what's been presented, I can't corroborate. It doesn't appear to be to scale. It's a clip of a photograph, but there's no way to scale or identify the
accuracy. Can you scale on this particular one here then?
Yes.
Can you scale on this photograph here?
No.
So that your evidence cannot be scaled either. Well, this is actually, I did these, for the record, I took the photograph and I did the scaling on this.
Well, let's boil it down to what the question is or what
the question is. I question the stacking, and that in the very photograph here, two vehicles and a truck would actually, the truck would actually block the residence entrance.
Okay.
And that's quite common.
But aren't we comparing apples to oranges? I mean, that photo is the current condition. That rendering is what it would be. So, of course, that's going to be inferior to that.
But if I took these vehicles and superimposed it on this picture, the residents would be blocked.
Yeah, but we just heard you can't do that to scale.
I can state that is factually untrue because that entire entrance is being widened to 23 feet, which doesn't exist today, so that the visitor's lane will have a full 11 feet in a designated striped lane with a separate designated striped lane for residents that does not exist today. And that's why I said we're trying to remedy the deficiencies that I'm pleased to say I'm not the only one that's observed with the proposed plan.
And Mr. Dean, you said it was 170 feet from Schoolhouse Road. Where is that measured with the two points, the end point and the start point? Is that measured at the gate or is that measured at the window of the gatehouse?
It's measured from the window to the travel lane of Schoolhouse.
So this is 170 feet from right about here up?
Correct.
To where? To the center of the road? Because that must be, that's a change, because the plans that I have from the July-August timeframe showed it considerably shorter than that.
Well, that's my testimony, 170 feet.
Well, and it wasn't from the center lane. It was from the edge of the travel lane.
Correct.
Just for the record.
From here to there is 170 feet?
Correct.
Okay. Because the plans that we saw earlier did not show where the window was actually going to be on the gatehouse. Okay, I had another question regarding the GDP right now shows that this is going, they had the commercial, and there's a question as to whether or not that traffic was going to be inside or outside the gate. Now, in the existing gatehouse was way down here. So therefore, any traffic into there would have been outside of the gatehouse. I would have gone on to Metler's Road or Schoolhouse Road, and my understanding was never going to come in on Canal Walk Boulevard except for a pedestrian down here. Is that correct?
As I've testified, I don't know the answer to that question. I've heard two different answers by board members. I don't know that it's particularly relevant at this point.
I think it is relevant, because when you start talking about traffic count, you said that this is actually going to be a better arrangement. The 63 houses and the 61 houses are actually going to improve the situation, because we won't have all that commercial traffic. Well, that commercial traffic was never going to be on Canal Walk Boulevard to begin with. Plus, now, all the people that want to go to that retail have to go out to get it. Now they have to go down to Randolph and Schoolhouse Road or down the other way. So it's actually going to probably increase traffic. Now, the other question I've got, there are two construction.
And maybe, sir, you want to let Mr. Dean answer that
before
you go on to the next one, because he provided detailed testimony that was in direct contradiction to what you said, I think. So you want to let him explain before you go on.
I'm not sure there was a question. Because we don't know whether there was a direct connection from the boulevard to the proposed commercial component, it's irrelevant, because I look at traffic as it affects the community, not just Canal Walk, not just Canal Walk Boulevard, but also the impact of existing traffic on Schoolhouse Road. So by reducing and eliminating the commercial component, there's absolutely no question traffic will be reduced. If you want to measure it on a specific point on a specific road, then I can engage in that debate. But until I know definitively whether there was an internal connection or not, it's really a pointless argument.
If I could propose that we move on from that particular topic, because in my opinion, the whole issue is irrelevant anyway. The commercial was a permitted use. This is a permitted use. We're before the planning board for a permitted use, and we're talking about the best design for the gatehouse. The from my recollection is there was no, for the record, there was no connection to Canal Walk Boulevard for the commercial. I took Mr. Dean's testimony to basically say, overall, for the overall road network surrounding Canal Walk, compared to the original GDP to what is proposed, overall, these two developments are going to result in less overall traffic than the assisted living, congregate care, and the commercial. Take that for what it's worth. My opinion, it's irrelevant anyway, because they were all permitted uses. So we're not talking about a use variance trying to justify the use. We're here for permitted use and trying to figure out what's the best design for this road, the best design for this gatehouse.
I agree with you entirely, but I also want to focus in on the best design for the gatehouse. So we have to take traffic into consideration.
I think we're on the same page. I think the whole discussion about the what was or was not for the commercial is irrelevant. So let's.
I'm just questioning the numbers. That's all. Because if you subtract out. And say that the commercial is actually going to improve the situation. It would improve the situation on Metler's and Schoolhouse Road, but it would have no impact on Canal Walk Boulevard. In fact, the traffic is going to increase on Canal Walk Boulevard because we have 63 houses and we have 62 condominiums.
Which were originally contemplated in the original design of Canal Walk, because the number of units that were originally contemplated were over 1,200, and that's where we're at. So that was always in the mix. So it's not that we're adding new units that were never anticipated. Those units were always anticipated.
And I would agree with that entirely. However, the gatehouse was way down here. It wasn't going to be up on Schoolhouse Road, so it makes a big difference.
It's a good segue to, let's get back to the gatehouse.
Okay, back to the gatehouse. I had a question regarding the sequencing of the gates. As I understand it, first of all, the existing gatehouse, the turnaround is inside the gate. This is going to have the turnaround outside the gate, so in other words, you have to come into the community. The existing one, the gate, is actually the other side. You have the turnaround is before the actual gate. I don't know if you can see it on this picture or not.
You can.
But in the existing one, the gate is actually down here someplace on the existing one. Assuming this is the same thing except it's moved down. Now the person has to come actually go open the gate and come in and go around, whereas in the existing one, the turnaround is before the gate ever opens. So that's, I just want to point that out, because I also have a concern about the sequencing of these gates. Now, you've said that if a visitor is coming through, that the residence gate will be locked out.
Correct.
Okay. Now, so the resident coming in, he's going to go up, he's going to push his button, and he's going to expect the gate to open, and it doesn't open.
Correct.
So he's going to slam on his brakes, and if another resident comes up behind him, we're going to have rear-end collisions. You say that, it's not going to happen, but trust me, we're dealing with senior citizens. These types of things, I can foresee these happening now. We have issues now with the gates of people hitting the gates because they don't open up fast enough, so we'd have to re-educate our people, I guess. But I have, the concern because of the width here. This is 11 feet, this is 12 feet. A vehicle coming in here, you're going to hope that they line up and go down here. And as I said back in October, this is not England. We don't get in queues. We don't line up. So that's a concern that I have as well. I also have concerns down here because of the turns. Now, you said everything is not going to be an issue here, but I do see that there will be issues down here as well. The photographs, again, I question the photographs because I have photographic evidence to show something different.
Why will there be issues down there? You made a statement. Why is that going to happen? I heard his testimony with care being taken and a procedure being established to make there not be or make there be as few problems. Why are you saying that there are going to be problems?
Okay, I see traffic coming this way, this way, this way, that way, that way. There's an awful lot of traffic going on.
Well, isn't that an awful lot of traffic for this kind of a development all to be happening coincidentally at the same time?
I don't see it that way. If you sit out there and watch the gate, these types of things happen all the time. Now, I did have a question. With the existing gatehouse, there's some confusion as to where this on the 63 houses, where this road is going to come in. I believe it is not going to come in where the gatehouse is. It's going to come in roughly where the fire hydrant is. Is that roughly where it comes in? Because people seem to think that it's the construction road. It's not the construction road. It's further up. The other question I had is there are two construction roads functioning right now. There's one coming in off of Schoolhouse Road that comes in to the back end. I believe it's either Constitution or Saratoga. I'm not sure what it's called when it comes in there. And there's another one that comes in over here. Now, when those are closed off, there's an awful lot of traffic that comes in that way. Matter of fact, we had last Saturday, we had a bed delivered, and we were waiting for them for the gate to call us, and the truck showed up in our front yard. I said, "How'd you get in?" He said, "We come in the construction gate." Everybody does that. They don't bother to go through the front gate. They actually come in the construction road. So when those construction roads are shut off, there's going to be a lot more traffic coming in through the gate.
Yeah, there's a couple things that are interesting. The turnaround, you know, might be good to have before the gates, right? You don't want somebody coming in and having to actuate the gate and back out and, you know, let them turn around before the gate, before they get to the gate if they made a mistake and they don't need to be there. That would make sense. The other thing is, the other good point I thought you made is the one about the resident, you know, expecting their car to work, expecting to run right through, and not having that work. So now you think, is my card messed up or whatever? So is there a way, You said there's a relay. Is there a way to make that relay work in one direction where the resident always has preference and the visitor is the one who's locked out if the resident actuates the gate but not vice versa?
That is precisely how it works. Okay. If that the resident actuates the gate, the visitor can't proceed.
But not in the reverse.
If the visitor is admitted, then the resident gate won't go up. And I explained,
okay,
just because of the scenario, which candidly I don't believe will happen, but mm-hmm. but just for that added measure of safety, we wanted to ensure that that merge condition between the visitor lane and the resident lane works properly. Mm-hmm. There's no such control today.
Right.
And although the resident design is not the best, unless I've missed something throughout this whole process, I believe it works free from defect today without these additional safeguard measures that we've proposed. So I do have to take exception to the fact there was a statement made that said, if you watch this all day, I'm sure you'll see a problem. I've been watching this all day for a month and a half. I've not seen a problem. And that's why, at my recommendation, we went through the exercise to have this camera installed so that, as the professional before you who has to opine on safety, and as a traffic engineer, my highest priority is to ensure motorist, pedestrian safety. I would not be before you, and I've done so for the past 30 years, advocating something that was inherently unsafe. What you have before you has now been borne out through empirical data with endless hours, and we've recorded it. There is a means to dispel the myth, and that's what I've tried to introduce with these photographs, is that this operation, while it does have constraints, it's not a safety problem. And certainly our proposed design is even better than what exists today.
I have a question, though. Could you design or have the alternating opening functioning of the gates, even if one were moved forward? Couldn't they still operate? So in theory, you could move the gate so a visitor could turn around without going through the gate, and they would still function the way you designed them.
The proposed visitor's gate, which now is before the cutout, could very easily be moved to the other side of the island.
All right. The other thing I want to make sure that I'm not too old and I missed it, but didn't you mention something about, and I don't believe there's going to be a problem with blocking the entrances with the two lanes. But in the event that there is, didn't you say that the average wait would be about 1 minute?
It's even less than that.
So if that truck is happening to block one of the lanes momentarily, it's basically less than waiting at a stoplight.
The typical delay, and I don't know this for a fact, but it's been described to me, is that the delay exists for an inbound visitor vehicle if the resident is paged and they don't answer. So then the driver has to wait. So if someone's expecting a furniture delivery or a service call and they don't happen to be near the phone or the communication device, yeah, there'll be a little bit of a delay. And that's the nature of having a gated community.
Have you done these locking doors in other places? Have you had experience with that?
I've never found them to be necessary, so I've not done them. And they're offered as an additional means of safety. But essentially what happens is this relay alternates power between the two gates so that only one gate can actuate at a time. Unlike the old days on the parkway where gates could go up simultaneously.
Right, but you must have done some research on the system.
It's a simple electronic relay.
What I'm getting at is there any research that says there's an extraordinarily high number of rear-end collisions as a result of a system like this because someone doesn't stop or they expect to see the gate to open the instant the cards flashed? Is this in the research, is this listed as a problem?
No. As with any attendant that has a booth, there are vehicle sensors, oftentimes for the outbound movement, where as a vehicle approaches, the gate comes up.
So, but then I guess, again, so I'm not old and missing anything. It's like anything else that involves people. There are opportunities for mishaps.
And that's why in this design...
But it's not more so than anything else, and everybody's not a moron.
Sadly, sometimes I feel, though, I must design for that, and that's not meant to be disparaging. That's the degree of standard that exists in traffic engineering, is that people drive on the wrong side of the road, and they don't pay attention to red signals, and there are so many factors of safety built in to this type of operation. I will say that accidents happen when people don't pay attention. And so if a resident hits their device and the gate does not actuate and they're not paying attention, they'll hit the gate. But it's incumbent upon that individual who has the privilege via a driver's license to pay attention to what they're doing. And I can't design for that person, even though for this case, we basically have.
All right, thank you, and I apologize for cutting into your time.
I should make a crass commercial. I do teach doing a seminar on human error reduction, and this is a classic case of what you don't want to do from a human error reduction standpoint. The only other question I've got now is, I understand that if a vehicle comes in and the guard opens the gate for a visitor, and the visitor starts to work their way down and gets down to about this position, this gate will not open. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. So, again, our people are going to see the vehicle down here. They're going to see the gate closing. They're going to come on through. This is a classic example of human error reduction type of situation. It's going to happen. Hopefully, it doesn't cause any serious problems, but it is going to happen. That's all I have.
Well, thank you. Anybody else? Dan?
If you could raise your right hand for me, do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
If you could state your name, spell your last name, and provide your address for the record, please.
My name is Dan Glicklick, G-L-I-C-K-L-I-C-H. I live at 27 Jay's Corner in Canal Walk.
Thank you.
the engineer, if the gate were to be moved,
Take the mic, please, just so that it picks up. Thanks.
I'm thinking of unintended consequences, and I can't think of any, so I want to ask the engineer. If the gate were moved down here so that a car could turn around before he went through the gate, what might some unintended consequences be, positive or negative?
The objective in the design you have before you is that the visitor would have the best possible awareness of an inbound residential vehicle, and that's because it's directly parallel to him, so he would know that the gate is down and he would feel as though he could proceed with confidence. As that gate is moved deeper into the site, he then doesn't have and enjoy the same line of sight for an approaching resident. Now, with the gate lockout system, it's not as great a concern. And that's why I've said the gate can be moved if there's a compelling concern or overriding concern that people will errantly be admitted into the community or disregard the guard and come in for nefarious purposes. I can't predict that. But certainly, if the board feels it's important and the community, absolutely, mechanically, traffic-wise, that gate can be moved.
Well, my thought is, in terms of safety, where there'd be less chance of an accident. I don't know how often someone's going to come in and disregard the guard and go flying through. I don't know that happens very often. But it does happen often where people have to make a U-turn and go out because the person they're coming to visit isn't there. right now, on here you have... There's a space here in that island, and your new plans show no spaces in the island at all. Is there a reason for that?
Correct. Didn't feel that there was a need for it.
Okay, because that's a possibility for a turnaround.
It doesn't have the same bubble as a, I'll say, sanctioned U-turn. Candidly, I'm not sure of the purpose of that original median break. Again, it's something that if the board... where the public felt was an essential component, Mr. Heibel can very easily redesign this, the proposed plan on B2 to replicate the preceding median cut before the guardhouse.
I don't know why it was there. That's why I'm bringing it up, but I just noticed that it's not there.
Correct.
Now, and I didn't know if there was a reason for it.
I couldn't discern a purpose for it, so okay. I didn't include it.
My next question is, I looked at the photographs, and I was in the back, so I couldn't see the times on all of them. Do you have photographs from 6 a.m. to 9 a.m.? Because that's when I think the heaviest traffic coming in and out, especially residents, would be. There are a number of residents who are still working. There are people, I did it, by the way. I did a traffic study there. And I noticed a lot of people going out, and then the same cars coming back 20 minutes later. They're going out for coffee or whatever it is, and then they come back. So there seemed to be more traffic early in the morning than noontime, even deliveries, and people coming into paved driveways are coming in typically at 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock in the morning. And I didn't see any photographs from
that. And the reason for that was I didn't see any queuing at that time. I can't tell you there isn't more traffic, but my focus as part of this whole exercise is queuing for the visitor lane and how that relates to potential stacking up to schoolhouse. So yeah, at 8 o'clock in the morning, 8:30 in the morning, when I got into the office, my screen would show the camera, and I didn't see anything that warranted me taking a screen capture as an exhibit. So I didn't bring in the pictures that show nothing, but it's the overwhelming majority. I didn't even take a picture.
Okay, that's what I was asking, because when I did the traffic count, there was more traffic at 8 o'clock in the morning than any other time.
There may have been more traffic, but there was less stacking.
Yeah, I didn't count the stacking. I just counted the cars coming in and out.
That was my focus, is stacking. Okay.
Do you know how many cars per household per hour come in at different times?
No. We've counted. We, as part of our regular monitoring, we've performed traffic counts at the Boulevard and Schoolhouse. So I can tell you on the day we did the count and between certain hours, how many cars came in. Mm-hmm. But that's not changing. It's as part of the application. I mean, we do have a nominal increase associated with the proposed single-family homes in the enclave, but I just don't have those numbers in front of me, but we've studied it.
Okay. I do know the state DOT has the numbers of in adult communities between certain hours, how many cars per hour per household.
In the case of a study of Canal Walk, which is the most relevant metric, we have that data.
Okay, I have no other questions.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dan. Anyone else wishing to speak?
Hi, hello. Dina Lux, 51 Patriots Way.
If you could raise your right hand, do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Great, thank you.
Just want to know, this area where they're going to merge, that's going to be down here near where the enclave entrance is? That's the merge where they alternate when they come in?
Correct. It is before, right, or I'll say north of the enclave entrance.
Okay, I mean, it looks pretty close. I just want to tell you that you, like in the present configuration where the guardhouse is now, there is a yield sign there, so that it kind of there is a reminder for people to yield. People don't yield. I see that as a problem, especially in our community. We have people in our community, we have stop signs throughout the community. People don't stop. They don't pay attention to stop signs, let alone yield signs. I see that as a problem when two cars are trying to come in and merge there right near an enclave entrance.
Thank you. I mean, we believe that having watched hours of this exhibit and the merging condition that we've designed something that's safe and provides visibility. As I've said, I can't design around inconsideration. And one of the reasons the interlock system for the gates was proposed is to avoid any future issue with the concern of yielding. It happens by design because of the alternating gate systems.
Okay. Sir?
My name is Robert Rossomando. That's spelled R-O-S-S-O-M-A-N-D-O. I'm at 42 Patriot Way.
I thought you could raise your right hand for me, sir. Do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you, sir.
I've lived at Patriot Way going on 8 years, and I heard all the arguments for the negative side of this, and quite frankly, I do not believe that they outweigh the current conditions that we have now. And that is, I don't think it's fully been explained, but when you come into this community and the homeowner's gate raises and we go through, we have to make that sharp left-hand turn and then a right-hand turn to get back onto the main road again. In front of us are two utility boxes from public service. Those boxes are about 2 feet high, 3 feet long, and maybe another 2 feet wide. They're fairly large, and they are public service. I don't know if they're power. I have no idea what they are. There's also a curb in that area where you have to make the sharp S turn. And if you look at the curb, you can see a number of tire marks where people, I guess, didn't make it. So I would say anything that I've seen to date is far better than what we have currently. And I'd do anything to get rid of what we have because it definitely is unsafe. It shouldn't be there. It should never been accepted, in my opinion, humble opinion, to begin with. So that's all I have to say. If you're asking me to swap, I'll take this any day to what we have now. Thank you.
Hi, Lawrence Paul, P-A-U-L, 7 Patriots Way in Somerset. I'm a resident of Canal Walk. Just
if I could stop you for 1 sec, if you could raise your right hand, do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you, sir.
So just 2 questions. One is, I guess, maybe it's obvious. There will be a bathroom in the new guardhouse? Yes. Okay, so that should help out considerably. My only real question is, I don't quite see how we can separate the enclave entrance from the gatehouse. I know that's what was stated at the beginning, but aren't they totally related to each other, per what the previous questioner said as well? I mean, couldn't there be issues of relationship that we need to discuss? We can't approve one before the other.
I'm not sure your question is. What happens is this particular design, as depicted on B2, affects the design of the enclave driveway. So if there's an alteration to this, it could have an impact on the design that necessitates an amendment to those plans.
Okay.
So it's we wouldn't put the cart before the horse. Why have the board deliberate on enclave, approve it, and then engage in this debate about the guardhouse, which could then trigger the need to amend. Okay. That's why. Thank you.
Merrill Taub, 4 Benjamin Street, Canal Walk.
Mr. Taub, if you could raise your right hand for me, do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you, sir.
I just have a question for Mr. Dean. He mentioned the RSI, and I wondered if it addresses the number of entrances that are proper for 1,250 housing units.
Not specifically. Canal Walk, I might even predate RSIS. So for these new sections, the enclave and the singles, RSIS does apply. But in terms of Canal Walk in general, it's been approved.
Okay, let's put it like this. You're a traffic engineer and you're designing today, would you have a subdivision of this size with just one main entrance?
Well, there are secondary entrances, and there are emergency access points. So I don't see a problem with it, in short.
In short, Okay, just your professional opinion.
Correct.
Thank you.
And Mr. Dean, just let me ask you, there are secondary access points other than, let's not count emergency exits, that's not really fair, right? There's one.
There's a full access for residents only on Weston Road. It's also a gated entrance, gated exit on Weston Road, but that's a resident-only entrance and exit.
On a scenic road.
At the last meeting, I mentioned the possibility of putting an entrance onto Mettler's Road. Was that considered?
We looked at that, and it was our feeling that it was not necessary because of the numbers of vehicles coming in and out, that there are not enough. There's plenty of access at the existing entrance and the secondary entrance where it's not necessary.
This would be a residence-only entrance and exit.
But I'll let Mr. Dean deal with that.
Well, let's circle back to that just so we don't interrupt the sir.
You could raise your right hand for me, sir. Do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you, sir. Could you state your name, spell your last name for the record, and provide your address?
My name is Lawrence Wissman, W-I-S-S-M-A-N, and I live at 6 Mayflower Court. Thank you. A couple of comments. The ratio of visitors to residents was mentioned earlier as being like 90 to 10 or 95 to 5, and in terms of queuing, if we had a gate out, as we have recently, where actually the entrance, the residence gate on both the Weston Road and from Schoolhouse Road failed, and so imagine that the number of cars coming through at 90-10 or 95-5 would be somewhere between 9 and 20 times more than the visitors. Just something to think about. It seems like it could be a potential issue. My main point in asking for your attention for a moment is to say that one of my main reasons for selecting Canal Walk as an age-restricted community that's gated for security is to assure that, among other things, the security that I assumed and was told would be provided by the establishment would be provided. And therefore, I would strongly encourage the moving of that gate to beyond the turnaround so that unauthorized vehicles do not enter. I'm very concerned about the potential for security issues, and I consider myself relatively spry compared to some of my fellow residents. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, one more shot.
Do I have to be sworn in again?
No,
you do
okay.
Not.
Okay.
Just state your name again for the record.
Dina Lux, 51 Patriots Way. And it's L-U-C-H-S, because one time it was spelled wrong in the minutes. I just have to say, and it's not really a question, it's an observation, if that's okay. Mr. Dean, I know you've done this wonderful traffic study and you've showed us all these pictures. You don't live there. And whatever you give us now, whatever the planning board votes on, is something we have to live with. And once this is done, this is it. We can't suddenly put another road in somewhere to make it easier if we find that there's going to be a backup of traffic and it's going to be very difficult. And there are going to be some collisions or whatever. And, you know, to say that you can't help it if people aren't careful, we've seen it. We live there and we've seen it. And we've seen that people aren't always careful. We've seen the gate broken many times by people who don't wait until the gate goes down and up. It is an issue. And I really hope that the developer and the engineers go back and look at the possibility of having another exit and entrance for the community. When you say we don't need it, we're telling you as a community, yeah, we do need this. So I just want to share that with you and share that with the planning board.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Yes. my name is Jim Little. I live on Patriots Way, 36.
Mr. Little, if you could just raise your right hand for me, do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you, sir.
And I know we may have been a little bit long-winded this evening, so I'll try to be concise and give you my view. So I'm just going to read what I think about the evening and other things. I'm the president of the Canal Walk Homeowners Association, and I'm speaking on behalf of the resident board members who are with me tonight. And I'm just going to take my glasses out so I can read it a little more easily. A matter of background, in October of 2014, we were contacted by the applicant regarding the plan to add housing units to Canal Walk. And we discussed the best option for housing and recommended the lower density single housing families as the best option for Canal Walk for many of the reasons that you've heard tonight. In late December of that year, we saw the first iteration of the proposed layout, and since then there's been several more that you have seen. We then immediately arranged for two community meetings hosted by the applicant and these experts to discuss what they've been discussing tonight at the initial stages to make sure everybody was informed. Since that time, we've had many meetings with the applicants and reviewed various modifications to the plans as a board. These modifications included many of our requests, many of which you've seen tonight incorporated into the program. For example, an enlarged gatehouse with bathroom for the guard. Now, that may seem simple, but when the guard's not in our current gatehouse, it's a problem because we have an unprotected gate. We think it's a much more secure vehicular entrance to the community. In addition, we were aware of some of the input the township officials were providing and others were reviewed. We understand that the applicant has the right under the original documents that permits this use, and the most recent review was of the plan before you today. We also had our professional engineer who's working on our transition study and our board attorney, our Canal Walk board attorney, review the options that we had. And based on that foregoing, the resident board members unanimously agree that the applicant's plan for additional housing, while not perfect and not recognizing everything we requested, is much preferred than the shopping center, additional apartments, or assisted living facility, and therefore is acceptable to the board with the following proviso. Any other questions should be resolved among the planning board members, yourselves, appropriate town officials, and the applicant. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, anyone else?
One more?
Yep. So we'll go till 9:30. It gives like five more minutes, and then we gotta close.
My name is Lucille Taub, and I live on Benjamin Street.
If you could raise your right hand for me, Ms. Taub. Do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
Thank you, ma'am.
I am not an engineer. I work in the arts. However, Mr. Dean, I have to tell you, I don't know what day you were there, but I came home in my daughter's car, and I didn't have my clicker to get in, so we were in the guests, visitors line. We were number five because the guard wasn't in the guardhouse. And behind me were three and one coming in the gate. So that's a lot more stack than we've been discussing. And I want you to know that was on a Wednesday at 11:45 about a month ago.
That has been my understanding with the current practice. And I think hopefully all of us in this room can agree that to continue that practice is in no one's interest.
The other thing, as far as the gates locking and all, I'm certainly no expert. I can see where it could be a problem when people are not paying attention and then they jam on their brakes. the biggest complaint that I have with the gates now is that the guard raises the gate when someone's there, and I'm going through. And I have to stop, or I will have an accident. And so perhaps that is better, but I can see people are right that there will be a little problem.
Well, and recognizing that very concern and the abruptness that residents now have to make to get back into the travel lane is precisely the reason we will have a device that alternates sides, that only one vehicle can proceed
but
at a time.
Can you have some kind of a warning or something so that the people, the residents, know that that gate may not open? Is there anything you can do about that? I don't know. But
when you say it won't open, my observations, and just for the board's edification, is that with no criticism to anyone that's in the room, speeding through this community is an issue. And I have to leave it to the citizens to regulate that among themselves. Obviously, having a gate that's closed and doesn't open a quarter mile in advance so that people can speed through this system, I think is better for everyone involved. If that requires a bit of accommodation in your practices to become a safer community, I'm going to advocate that.
Well, I don't know. I thought perhaps there might be some kind of a safeguard.
The safeguard we have,
warning signal or something. I don't know.
Well, that's like saying I need a warning that the light won't turn green.
Yeah.
It's red. It's supposed to be red, and you're supposed to stop.
I know. Everybody's supposed to. I know. I'm just throwing it out to you.
I understand that. I think, obviously, by moving the entire system closer to the schoolhouse, is that one cannot get up the same running travel speed that one can today where the gate is.
The other thing I want to, you talked about that turnaround and why was it there. There are times that I've noticed people who are not from the area think it's a street, and they turn down into our community, and they realize they don't belong there, so then they use the turnaround to go out. That's why it was there.
And again, the frequency of that, I've never measured.
We can
still accommodate that errant path even under the proposed design. Mm-hmm. And again, I'm getting the sense that there might be a preference, and I don't know how we take a straw poll, on resetting the visitor's gate to the other side of the curb opening. And that would obviously address that concern. Someone will still have to talk to the guard to say, oops, I shouldn't be here. And they do.
Thank you.
Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, it would be good to not have people who don't, who don't belong there, but who made a mistake, not have to, you know, potentially continue on into the community, because that defeats the purpose of it.
Yeah. Just one quick question.
Can you state your name, Andrew?
Jean Mara, 77 Bayard.
I just have a question.
Need to swear again. Just if you could raise your right hand for me. Do you swear the testimony you're going to provide us the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Thank you.
One question is, the common sense would prevail. Why can't there be a third entrance for the people who live in the community, for the residents? That would alleviate everything here. All commercial trucks that are coming in while their building is going on, all the people who are having things done in their homes. I think one of the things that would help, if we could come in, like the people do in the reserve, they come in the back entrance. Why can't they have another entrance off of Mettler's Road? That's what I'd like to ask.
Well, we've not proposed it, and I've not seen a demonstrated need for it in terms of capacity or traffic engineering. It may be wanted, but I can't see a reason that it's necessary.
Well, like Dina said, if you live there, you know there is a need.
You're looking at it from an engineer's point of view.
That's the only perspective I have.
Look at it from a psychological point of view, where if there's only one entrance and one exit, you feel trapped.
Some people may say they feel safer.
No way.
Each point of entry.
There's a trapped feeling knowing that there's only one entrance and one exit. I know I would feel that way.
It's not the case here, as I understand.
Again, for the record, there are two entrances and two exits to this community. Also, for the record, just, you know, I've done other active adult communities in this municipality, and I believe all of the other active adult communities only have one entrance and one exit. I think this is the only one with two.
Yeah, nothing said. Well, here's what I would do. I don't know that we can resolve this tonight. So let me just be clear. I'm going to give you one more bite at the apple, and then we're going to call it a night. Because first of all, everyone may not have understood. We're not actually voting on anything tonight.
Well,
right?
I would like, since we addressed all the issues on the 63 units, at least give me the subdivision approval on that, because I've got other things to do before we ever start building them. I don't think there are any issues with respect to the 63 units. And the other thing I would like to do is at least get a vote on the location of the guardhouse. Again, we have to, we can move the gates. We can have that discussion down the road. But I can't design the enclave until we can fix the location of that guardhouse.
Yeah, I get it. So people were concerned about the guardhouse. So essentially, you're saying we can essentially get another bite at the apple when we talk about the enclave, right?
We have to come back for the enclave.
Yeah, and I think, Mr. Chairman, I think he wants the subdivision approval, and he wants a general recognition that, based on what we've heard so far, that this location seems acceptable.
Right. No,
when they come and do the enclave, you reserve the right to take another look at it if there poses a problem. But
yeah,
they want to design that enclave.
No, there can't be perpetual uncertainty on the case of the applicant. But so the only thing I would say about Mettler's Road is, I don't know. I'm of two minds on it. But I guess. Turn the question around more simply, and again, we can come back to this at another time. Would it be feasible to put another entrance there from an engineering point of view only? Because if you tell me that it's not for whatever the reason, then the discussion's moot. But if you say, it's feasible, it's doable, then the question becomes more of a need.
And we haven't looked at it in its entirety, so I don't want to answer the question to say it's not or it isn't, but I hear your question, and we can get you an answer to that.
Yeah, because we did mention that the last time. I mean,
right.
This issue came up, and I think we owe it to finish this discussion.
Yeah, there's two parts to it, and we didn't analyze. There's a question of can it be done, and the second question is it necessary, which is also another analysis that we did not do. So if you want us to do an analysis of can it be done and is it necessary, because I think that's also very relevant.
Yeah.
Well, I think as far as whether it's possible, the rest of the majority of Mettler's Lane is spoken for. I mean, there are homes, existing homes, lining from Weston up to almost this point. The only place on Mettler's where a second entrance could possibly be put
is where the commercial entrance would
be. Is this 63 lot subdivision.
Right.
And then I think the more relevant question is, I think it certainly could be done, but then I think the question really is, what benefit will it have? I mean, in my mind, you know, the entrance on the other entrance that's on Weston, you know, I think that has some utility because it's on the other side of the development. It serves that other half of the development. Here you'd be putting another entrance right next to this main entrance. How much of a benefit would it really serve?
Well, again, I don't want to completely deal with that issue tonight, but I would say this. I would say that I'd like to hear an analysis, and I think that the applicant has a right to opine on the need of it from your standpoint. We have the right to hear what the public says based on their need for it, and we can make a decision based on that. I think, you know, the applicant, obviously, if we're asking you to investigate an engineering question, we wouldn't be doing that if you know, we didn't feel there might be a need for it, but you certainly have every right to have your opinion on the need as much as we or the public do. So I would say that that is a perfectly legitimate testimony to present at the next time we do talk about this. So let's just leave that at that. You get one more shot, and then we're going to close the public for tonight.
One last bite of the apple. A couple of points. We stated
Sir,
earlier
just state
that
your name one time for the record, just so.
Leon Krals, K-R-A-L-S, 14 Patriots Way. It was stated that the issue of the 63 houses and the 62 condos is the best solution. I don't think anyone here tonight has disputed that. All we're disputing is the location and the configuration of the guardhouse. So I want to make that clear. Also, it was stated that this is going to be a much better design because the gatehouse would have a bathroom. Well, that's an OSHA requirement. So it's really a moot point. That's a nice thing to say, but it really doesn't have anything to do with the issue here. Now, I'm concerned about voting on the 63 houses because the 63 houses, the storm water management of the 63 houses is contingent upon the other side of Canal Walk Boulevard. You can't have the 63 without enlarging the storm retention on the other side. And once you do that, you're locked in there, and then that locks in the design of the condominiums, and it locks in the guardhouse. So that's a concern. They lock them all in. They're all it's almost like a chain. You have to have them all together. I want to throw out one other thing, although it's not part of this particular application. I made reference a little bit earlier to another construction entrance, which I believe is actually off Shenandoah. It is what's now called the Reserve North Road. To my knowledge, it's not on any of these maps here, but to my knowledge, there's no house to be built there. It's used as a construction entrance right now. That would be an ideal location for a third resident entrance and exit, because all those people that live there now do the big loop to come all the way around to go out onto Schoolhouse Road. So they could put another entrance exit for residents only on Schoolhouse Road. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And we will have asked the applicant to investigate that. So I'd like to motion to close the public.
Move to close to the public.
Aye. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. What we should do is have a motion and a vote on the 63 unit.
Mr. Chairman, I think Councilman Chase has something to say.
Yeah, Ted.
I'm sorry to bring this up now, but the thought occurred to me, you know, during the public session that, Mr. Dean, it seems to me that your justifications for putting the visitor's gate where it is are sort of conflict with each other, because if you have the two gates at the same position, but only one of them opens at a time, then the cars in the visitor's lane and the residence lane will never be parallel to each other because one gate is shut and the other one is open. So I think that sort of removes the justification for having the visitor's gate there rather than behind where the unentering will turn around. And a second point is it would seem to me simple to have a little red light on the visitor's, on the residence gate to show when it is shut because the visitor's gate is opening. Very simple to do that.
Okay, can you hold those thoughts, Ted? Because what I'm going to do is, again, we should have a vote on the 63 lot subdivision, because that is all the comments have been addressed, and that can proceed in the current configuration. Even so, what we should also do is, we can't have a vote on the guardhouse, but I think what we can do, and Ted was ahead of me, is to just go through the board and kind of give you our guidance on it so that you have some something definitive, right?
Mr. Orsini,
yeah.
When I asked for the vote on the guardhouse, again, we can move gates, and we could talk about that next month. I mean, we sort of need to at least get guidance that the location of the guardhouse there is appropriate,
yeah,
whether we move the turnaround.
That and probably more.
That's the most critical thing, is that the guardhouse should be in that location. The rest of it, we can go back and tweak. We could take Ted's comments, some of the public's comments, and look at them and come back with design. But we need to fix.
So the location, I mean, more than the details of where gates and anything are going to be, but the location.
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you for help. We'll focus on that as well as some other stuff. So with that, I think I'd entertain a motion on the 63 lot single family subdivision.
Mr. Chairman, can I ask a question?
Sure.
Okay. Question has come up about a third entrance. Certainly, if this subdivision is approved, then that precludes, as is, then that precludes a third entrance being in this section onto Mettler's Road. Let's put it that way. Now, I guess the question then comes, would the applicant entertain the idea of looking at a third entrance in the location where the other construction entrance is on off of the Schoolhouse Road?
You've asked us to take a look. We will take a look, and what also may be even better, since we do have to come back next month, is ask for preliminary subdivision on the 63 and not ask for final subdivision on the 63. So in the event that we have to tweak something there, you get to look at it again.
In that case, I will make a motion for the preliminary.
And I will second the motion for preliminary.
Pull that.
Councilman Chase.
Okay. So this is just on the subdivision.
Just preliminary.
Not talking
approval.
About the yes. Location.
Correct.
Yes.
Mr. Howe.
Yes.
Mr. MacGyver.
Yes.
Mr. Mettler.
Yes.
Mr. Onyaka.
Yes.
Mr. Thomas.
Yes.
Chairman Orsini.
Yes. Now, I'm going to, since I feel that this end of the table has weighted themselves, I'm going to start with you, Charles, and I'm going to just go. And in 30 seconds, focusing on the location of the guardhouse, and certainly with any other comments that you care to make to give the applicant guidance, give us your opinion on their current design in B2.
My current opinion, I think the recent design is good, but there should be a consideration on the individuals living in the area. We should consider their own interests too.
Thank you. Bob?
The physical location, not dealing with the turnarounds, but the physical location of the guardhouse is fine.
Bob?
I would say the same thing. When we're dealing with the location, it's fine.
Three things. The guardhouse location is fine. I would like to see the gate move to beyond the turnaround. I would also like to see a sign on that visitor's area explaining to the people why the gate, the residents have the right of way, and that they will have to wait until the resident gate is closed before they can proceed. And thirdly, I would like to see an entrance exit for residents only on Mettler's.
I pretty much concur with everything Seal said. I think that, you know, the Mettler's should be explored only because we raised the issue the last time, and I think it's fair to follow that to its logical conclusion. I like the location, and I also agree that any mechanism that can deal with turning around before entering the community is a plus. But I think that, as most people agree, this design is far preferable to what is there now.
I think the proposed location of the gatehouse is appropriate, particularly because you have two separate traffic lanes all the way out to Schoolhouse Road. And therefore, if there is queuing at the visitor's gate, it still should not block the residence gate. I can't guarantee that there won't someday be a truck that is in the middle, but by and large, I think this is a good layout. I do think that the gate for visitors should be beyond the turnaround. I think that if there were to be a third entrance, I think the location further west on Schoolhouse, where there has been for a long time a construction entrance, or approximately there, would serve the residents of the whole project much better. An exit entrance from Mettler's to this proposed subdivision would benefit the residents of this subdivision marginally, because they're already the closest to Canal Walk Boulevard, and it would not benefit anybody else in Canal Walk at all. So if there is to be another entrance, it should be further west on Schoolhouse. And Schoolhouse really gets you places faster than Western Road.
Yeah. Okay, Carl?
The location of the guardhouse is fine. You may want to widen to extend some queuing, additional maybe five or six vehicles all the way to Schoolhouse. You may want to widen both of those aisles to be 12 feet all the way out. Renaissance has two dedicated island lanes going in, as well as other communities, and also move the water main.
Mike, I neglected one thing real quick. I think listening to the testimony, you should definitely strike the lanes. When we have to put up signs at gates, define everything, put stripes in the lanes too. That's my
They agreed to that, and they agreed to the water main movement.
As a matter of fact, on signage and things like that, and striping, we hopefully, when we come back, we'll have some sort of a plan.
Also, I'll defer to Ted on the other entrance. If the Schoolhouse one works out better, then that's fine.
Okay. We're done?
Thank you.
With that. So,
game on.
Franklin Juliet LLC, PLN 1500013. Wawa.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Peter Lanford appearing on behalf of the applicant. This is an application for site plan approval for the construction of a Wawa convenience store with gas at 607 Somerset, also known as the corner of Somerset Street, Juliet, and Myrtle. It fronts on three streets. There are two variances that we are seeking that deal strictly with signage. The application is a fully conforming application. It meets all of the bulk requirements of the zone, so we are not seeking any variances. There are a couple of design waivers that we are also seeking. Since this is in the Renaissance redevelopment area, there are certain design standards. Mr. Healy has pointed them out in his report. He has opined that some of them are warranted, and there are a couple others I'll deal with very briefly. I'm going to call three witnesses and try to be very brief with them. I'm going to call a representative of Wawa. I'll call the site engineer and also our traffic consultant. And I'm going to start with our Mr. Whitaker.
Raise your right hand for me. Do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
If you could state your name, spell your last name, and provide.
Could you use the mic, please?
Could you cut me off? Thanks, Pete.
Mark Whitaker, W-H-I-T-A-K-E-R, 1904 Main Street, Lake Como, New Jersey.
You got to put the mic real close to your mouth.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Great,
yeah, just got to be close. It doesn't pick up.
Right. Okay.
Mr. Whitaker, you're a licensed engineer in the state of New Jersey?
Yes, I'm a licensed professional engineer since 1998. I have a bachelor's of science in civil engineering.
Accept.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Whitaker, your firm prepared the site plan, which is the subject of this application?
Yes, we did.
Okay, and right now there is on the subject property an existing building, which was formerly Guaranteed Motors, and a huge parking lot, correct?
That's correct.
Can you indicate to the board what we are doing on the subject property?
Yes. I'll give you the highlights of the proposed development. If there's any questions or any additional detail that you seek, please ask.
Mr. Whitaker, looks like you're working off an exhibit that's been marked A1.
That is correct. A1 dated 12/16/2015.
And that is what?
That is a colored version of the site plan.
Great, thank you.
The property is known as Block 164, lots 1 through 26. We're located on Route 27 or Somerset Street, Juliet Avenue, and we have frontage on Myrtle Street to the rear. North on this plan is to the upper left corner. Currently, the site is vacant, and there's a two-story masonry building. The property is 1.7 acres in size, and we have four existing driveways, three of those driveways being on the state highway, Route 27, and one driveway being on Juliet Avenue. There's many existing nonconformances on this property, including setbacks and impervious coverage. We are in the Renaissance redevelopment area, and specifically the Renaissance commercial zone. A convenience store with a filling station is a permitted use, and that's why we're in front of the planning board. What we're proposing is a 5,051 square foot Wawa food market that is 22 and a half feet high. Exhibit A2, also dated 12/16/2015, our architectural floor plan and architectural elevations in color of the proposed food market. The food market is 22 and a half feet high, and it also contains a 33-foot high tower element, which is in the upper right-hand corner of this exhibit, is basically centered on the entrance to the food market. The architecture is a tan ephus on the upper three quarters of the building, and the lower half is, or the lower quarter, is a manufactured stone veneer, like a stacked stone. We have an exterior trash enclosure, which is on the rear of the facility. That is 16 feet by 35 feet in dimension and includes an 8-foot high masonry enclosure with self-closing steel gates on both sides. That trash enclosure houses a 5-cubic-yard compactor, a recyclables dumpster, and a storage shed for typical maintenance items such as lawn trimmers and salt. We also have a rear loading zone, which is to the rear of the building, which is to the left on the plan. That loading zone is 17 and a half feet in width and 60 feet in length. We are requesting one of the design waivers is for the loading zone not be within the area between the building and the right-of-way. I think that's impracticable on this particular site due to the fact that we have three frontages and that the front of the building is to face the state highway. Our rear loading zone is obviously on the left side of the plan, which faces Myrtle Street. It's impracticable to move the loading zone in another location. To offset the fact that we do have a loading zone in the rear of the site, we have provided two rows of staggered evergreen trees. In addition, we have a 6-foot high solid white vinyl fence. And that run extends from the southernmost property line all the way to the northernmost property line along Juliet Avenue to screen from a residential neighbor on Myrtle Street. With respect to the fueling canopy, it's called a stacked 6 canopy. There's 6 multi-product dispensers, which allows for 12 filling positions. Those are all 3+1, which is basically 3 grades of gasoline and 1 diesel fuel. The diesel fuel is for passenger vehicles and light duty vehicles only. We do not fuel tractor trailers. Attendants are instructed to actually turn away tractor trailers should they enter the site to try to fill with diesel fuel. With respect to access, we're proposing a single access point on Somerset Street, reduced from the 3 that I mentioned earlier. That is a full turning movement driveway. We've had an application with our pre-application with NJDOT, and there's no indication that they will not permit full access at that driveway. We also have one driveway on Juliet Avenue that's also full access, allowing all turning movements. In my opinion, the design of the driveways is safe and efficient. They're of proper width. They have adequate site visibility. There's stop control in the form of stop signs and painted markings. They're adequately illuminated, and they are fully accessible for all the design vehicles for this site, including WB50 tractor trailers, which deliver both to the fuel tanks and to the rear of the store. Your parking ordinance requires 41 spaces. We're providing 50 parking spaces, which is actually Wawa's ideal parking number for a site of this size. All the parking spaces are 10 feet by 20 feet in dimension, which meets your ordinance requirement. Again, we do have a design waiver for your ordinance does not permit parking in the area between the building and a right-of-way line. Exact same proof as far as the rear loading zone. We have three frontages. We would not be able to have much parking on the site whatsoever, so it's impracticable to not have parking in that area. All of the circulation on site is two-way, and all aisleways are a minimum of 26 feet in dimension, which meets your ordinance requirement. And as Mr. Lampert indicated, we comply with all the setbacks, your lot size, lot coverage, and we're actually reducing impervious coverage on this lot. With respect to lighting, all of our lighting is LED lighting. You're probably aware that's about 50% more energy efficient than metal halide lighting fixtures. We use a combination of 20-foot high pole-mounted lights. Those are all low-profile, full cutoff fixtures, state-of-the-art fixtures. We have wall packs around the building at key spots like doorways and loading zones. We also have LED lights underneath the porch. There's a front porch, as you can see on Exhibit A2 in the front of the facility. And we also have canopy lights, which are recessed underneath the canopy structure. As to landscaping, again, we have a double row of staggered evergreens along our westerly property boundary, along with that 6-foot high solid white vinyl fence. We have shade trees along Juliet Avenue, spaced at 40 feet on center, and 40 feet on center on Route 27, where it's not conflicting with existing or proposed utilities. We have shrubs circumventing the entire parking lot to screen headlights for parked vehicles. And we've provided shrubs and perennials at all the driveways to provide some visual interest as you enter the facility. Anything that is not impervious or shrubs or planting beds will be sodded and irrigated. To that end, we have 62 trees proposed, 337 shrubs, 85 ground cover plants for a total of 488 total plants. We are requesting a design waiver. With respect to landscaping, your ordinance requires a 10% landscaping within a parking lot. In my opinion, that's impractical on a site like this. That's more intended for like a shopping center where you have multiple rows of parking where you can introduce islands, or you can have a breakup of the long rows with islands. This type of design on this size of a lot is not conducive to providing internal landscape islands. We essentially have two areas where we could provide landscape islands in the front left and front right corner of the store. However, we use those for ADA accessibility. We have ADA accessible entrances off of Juliet and Somerset Street, which allow pedestrians to basically stop in that area and then enter the store and cross our aisles. With respect to stormwater, we meet NJAC 7:8, which is the stormwater regs under the state, the Delaware Raritan Canal Commission regulations, as well as your ordinance. Essentially, we're providing a surface basin at the corner of Juliet and Route 27, and an underground system, which is on the west side of the fueling canopy. Those systems combine and drain to Route 27. We meet all of the peak reductions that are required, and we provide water quality through the use of two manufactured treatment devices, one for each of those systems. As to signs, we're proposing one identification sign, a pylon sign.
Can we mark that as A3, and that's the Wawa sign package? I can do it while you're talking.
So that identification sign is located on Exhibit A1 on the site plan at our main entrance on Route 27. That sign is 20 feet in height and 50 square feet in area. We are seeking a variance. Your ordinance permits a sign height of 10 feet, and like I said, we're proposing 20 feet. We're also proposing a building sign, which is 66.7 square feet. That sign is situated at the tower element. It's these Wawa Goose and the Wawa Channel letters in the upper right-hand corner of Exhibit A3. That sign is 66.7 square feet. And we also have what we call spanner signs. The spanner sign is in the lower right-hand corner of Exhibit A3. It's simply the Wawa Channel letters. And that spanner sign is on each end of the canopy. The reason for that is so that customer knows that The fueling canopy is also owned and operated by Wawa, the food market. A lot of times when you go to convenience stores, you're not sure if the gasoline is a separate ownership or run differently. This is all owned and operated by Wawa. Those signs are 39.2 square feet, where your maximum allowable building sign is 30 square feet. In my opinion, these are typical C2 planning variances, where the benefits of granting the variance outweigh the detriments. Essentially, your ordinance requires a monument sign in this area. This is, in my opinion, not an area where we would want a monument sign. Monument signs are more ideal in areas where you have clear lines of sight, like Route 33 in Montgomery Township, where development is set back off the road, and you can see the monument sign very clearly as you travel down the highway. It's not the situation whatsoever on Route 27. Just east of...
Could you do me a favor? It's not picking up too good on the sound, if you could just thank you.
Just east of here, you have buildings that front directly on the roadway. As you approach the site, you would never see a monument sign. In addition, if there's any vehicles in the travel lane, it again would obscure a monument sign. That's why we proposed a pylon sign of 20 feet. It gives the motorists clear and safe identification of the site on the approach. With respect to negative criteria on those signs, again, I don't think it impairs any adjacent properties, and it's totally in character in this neighborhood as far as other identification signs, albeit they're in the city of New Brunswick, but they're of the same size and height as what we're proposing. And then we have two directional signs proposed. Those directional signs are at Juliet Avenue. Those are in the lower left-hand corner of Exhibit A3. Yeah. They don't even have the Wawa logo on them. They just say enter and exit to identify the driveway. So overall, in my opinion, this is a benefit. It's a redevelopment of a vacant, underutilized property. We're constructing a state-of-the-art, energy-efficient facility. We have an addition of substantial landscaping where none exists. We're creating a visual buffer screen to our residential neighbor in Myrtle Street. And we're reducing impervious coverage from 93% to 73% and greatly improving site access on the state highway.
Okay. A couple quick questions. Have you had an opportunity to review the staff reports that were generated in conjunction with this application?
Yes.
Let me particularly direct your attention to the report of Mr. Julio Vega, dated December 8, 2015. Can you, in essence, comply or willing to comply with all of the conditions of the report? And if not, which conditions do you have an issue with so we can put them on the record?
There's essentially two comments on page 4. Comment number 11 is with respect to a suggestion to limit lefts out on this driveway. We prefer not to limit turning movements at that driveway. Again, it's under DOT jurisdiction. All indications at this point are that DOT will approve that as a full access turning movement driveway. And in my opinion, that driveway is self-limiting. If you pull up, you see somebody queued there, you're not going to wait. You're just going to turn, go down to Juliet, and use a signal. So it's a self-regulating type of driveway. There's no reason to have...
So there's a signal at Juliet and...
That's correct.
Okay. Well, that's good. All right.
The other comment was number 12, which was also a suggestion to limit truck deliveries for both the fueling canopy and the store to not use Somerset Street. Again, I see no reason to limit that. Typically, we would want to have all truck deliveries come through our state highway driveway instead of coming down a residential street. We did provide truck turning plans in the site plan to illustrate that a truck can navigate through the entire site in both driveways. So we would not want to have a limitation. Additionally, it would be very difficult for Wawa to enforce drivers coming into the site and not using particular driveways. We would not want to introduce that type of confusion on the site with delivery vehicles.
Thank you. Mr. Healy's report. I think you've addressed most of the design waivers. Just very quickly, the screening of the mechanical equipment. Are you familiar where the mechanical equipment will be?
The benefit of the architectural design is that we have a flat roof, and this upper element, which is on exhibit A2, is a parapet, so all of the mechanical HVAC units can be on top of the facility and screened from all four sides.
And I think that's the only one.
All right. Well, just because, okay, let's give Mark a little bit of a chance, because there are some design considerations that we would like to talk about. You did address them, but that doesn't mean we all agree. So, Mark, why don't you hit the highlights of what you...
Yeah, well, the one they haven't addressed is the building design. I don't believe you addressed that one, the roof design.
I will have a representative of Wawa testify as to the building, the design. Okay. its genesis and as compared to the old design and why she, in her opinion, feels this is most appropriate.
Okay. Well, you've addressed the screening of the mechanical equipment. The one suggestion that I had with respect to the location of the loading, and I noted the same thing that you did, which is it's three frontages. There's just absolutely no way to comply with that. I did suggest that you wrap the screening around Juliet a bit, eliminate those four spaces in the back corner, because there is a residence across the street that would have a view directly into that service area.
I think we've already addressed that question with the last site plan revision. We actually wrapped the fence around this corner, and then these winged euonymus on this side are actually 5 feet high in nature, as opposed to these smaller shrubs on this side.
Yeah, I mean, I reviewed the revised plans. I think that my suggestion would be that it wrap around even to the back of the building.
So you want to?
You're over the parking by a number of spaces.
As I indicated, Wawa prefers sites with 50 parking spaces. They've done traffic studies at all of their facilities.
All right. Well, it's up for the board to decide.
One thing we could offer is to extend that fence along Juliet Avenue through those four parking spaces. It's a solid white PVC fence at 6 feet high. Also, the masonry enclosure is 8 feet in high. You can't see the trash compactor, the shed, or the dumpster within that enclosure.
And it's the service and loading area of a Wawa. So, I mean, that's up for the board to decide. I mean, the design standards call for screening of loading and service areas. In my opinion, it's not fully screened, and there's a residence across the street. I go to Wawa's all the time. I love their coffee. This is very much like the design on the one on Route 35 in, I guess, the Lawrence Harbor area, the same exact thing. I never see those spaces in the back ever used. And the people are coming in and out real quick. You'd never have 50 people parking in a Wawa, but that's, I don't know. The signage. You brought up a number of points. I guess the one issue, one concern that I have is, you had mentioned that it's not appropriate for the area. The language in our ordinance specifically addresses this. It says, although Route 27 is a state highway, it is intended for the corridor to retain the character of a local roadway, where controlled speed and pedestrian access and safety are priorities. Therefore, signage is recommended to be appropriately scaled, smaller in surface area and height. The standards in Exhibit 9 at the end apply to various potentially permitted uses. So, you know, the fact that it's lower in the sign area, the standards are lower, and that the sign height is lower is done for a purpose, to achieve something, to achieve a certain aesthetic, a certain look, and a certain scale. So can you address your proposal in light of the intent of the zoning ordinance?
Yeah, I actually read the same thing, and what stood out to me is the signage is to be appropriately scaled. In the context of a retail development like this, I think it is appropriately scaled. Oftentimes, you'll have ID signs of 200 square feet. Our sign is 50 square feet in size, which is smaller than all of our retail counterparts on the opposite side of Route 27. I do understand it's in a redevelopment area. You're trying to eliminate sign clutter, but we're proposing one sign at 20 feet, and really the sign height, as I said, it's for identification of the site. You will not be able to see a monument sign as you travel. Did it again tonight as you travel in a western.
Well, that's just not true. I mean, I don't agree with that at all. And then the other side of the street is not Franklin. It's New Brunswick. I think what Mark's asking you to address his specific points as to why you should be allowed to deviate, and mentioning the other side of the street really doesn't have anything to do with us, because that's New Brunswick. So.
Well, it's in character of the neighborhood. That was my point. But I don't really have any other arguments other than that it's a visibility issue.
The other issue, Mr. Haley and Mr. Chairman, this site has three frontages, two driveways. We are also, pursuant to the ordinance, since we have other street frontages, could put 10-foot signs on every street frontage if we needed to or wanted to. What we were proposing was one sign for the entire site rather than put a sign on Juliet. Obviously, Myrtle doesn't make any sense, but we could have put a sign on Juliet of 10 feet also, which is permitted pursuant to your ordinance. We felt that one sign to identify the site is most appropriate. Also, in having discussed this with my client a little bit earlier this evening, not to steal her thunder, my client had indicated that they can reduce the sign another 2 feet to 18 feet. And we also have our traffic consultant who can also give a reason why a little bit of a higher sign in this location is most appropriate. But I will defer to him when I call him.
I mean, I'd be interested to hear why a higher sign addresses site visibility. I mean, if a sign is lower, it's in the driver's line of sight as opposed to 120 feet in the air.
Next witness.
Okay.
The point is, if you're driving down the highway and there's vehicles in front of you, there's buildings directly. There's two large buildings on the east side. As you're driving down that line of sight, and the vehicles in front of you, it blocks at 10 feet. As you move away from the site, you need a higher sign to be able to see it. If the monument sign is only 10 feet high, you won't see it.
If there was an exhibit that proved that.
All right, well, why don't we come back to that with the
I have a couple questions.
Yeah, I have a couple. Yeah, Bob.
You mentioned the diesel pump is not for trucks. We have a facility going up at 1340. Hamilton, that in order to ensure that they you have the small size car hoses?
Yes, we do.
And the ones that it would take a truck 12 hours to fill up with?
Yep. They're regulated at 10 gallons per minute.
And I didn't check it. I wanted to get it specifically. There's a sidewalk improvement across the front.
We are proposing sidewalk improvements all along Juliet Avenue and Route 27.
Okay, and the last thing, I need help, because I don't know if this, I know on the zoning board, I think we got this condition through. I thought it was destined to be part of an ordinance, but new service stations, gas pumping facilities, were supposed to be required to have the ability to have emergency power to pump gas in the event of hurricanes. Is this facility going to be equipped?
It's not an ordinance requirement. That for the applicant before the zoning board, we're requiring that. But it's not an ordinance requirement.
Wawa employs a contractor that provides an emergency generator, so they're available 24 hours a day, 365 days a year in the event that there's a power loss. So they bring a portable generator to the site.
If that's what it ends up being, I'd really like to recommend that it be equipped to go right to an emergency power source in the event of emergency. We have so few places in Franklin for residents to do that.
It wasn't in our plan. I guess we can look at it and see if we can accomplish it, but the ordinance doesn't require it. Again, we will provide the emergency generator, but to have a permanent generator on site, I can't commit to it.
Yeah, Wawa hasn't employed permanent generators on sites, but as I indicated, they use a company that comes and provides the generator within 3 hours of them loss of power. During Hurricane Sandy along the shore, Wawa's were pretty much the only convenience stores that were open.
All right.
I have nothing further of this witness.
The board have any questions? Any other questions for this witness? Yeah, Carl.
I would strongly recommend relocating your water service line from underneath the detention basin. You'd be down like, you know, 8 feet. I did notice that looking at the plan. I already highlighted that. So.
Yeah. Yeah, that's.
Okay, next witness.
Yeah, that needs to be.
Lori.
Remain sworn in so we can always come back if we need to.
Do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? If you could state your name, spell your last name, and provide your professional address for the record.
Lori Kiedasch, K-I-E-D-A-I-S-C-H.
All right, Ms. Kiedasch, you can have a seat. By whom are you employed?
Wawa Incorporated.
And what is your position and what are your duties?
I am a project, real estate project engineer. I support our real estate, my real estate partners and construction and with the developers throughout the entitlement process.
Okay, and you are familiar with the building that is being proposed on this site?
Yes, I am.
Can you indicate to the board the materials being used and I know the floor exhibit A2 really basically shows the interior layout, but just take the board very briefly through that.
Through the interior?
Through the interior and exterior.
Sure, no problem. Okay, with the front elevation.
And keep the microphone closer to you.
Sure. Through the at the bottom portion of the building, we are showing an enhanced stone, and above we have stucco, and then we have a few roof lines here. We have the overhang, and then we also over the front, and then we also have the tower or the arcade at the entrance, which is stucco, and also with the stone piers, and then of course we have the tower. Clear glass at the front for visibility. On the side, again, we have the stone. We have the ephes with the facade. It's fake stucco windows here. And then we also in the rear, stone, facade, stucco in the rear. And on the other side, we have the spannered glass, stone, and the stucco.
And your mechanical equipment is going to be housed where?
Along the roof, and it is with the parapet there, you cannot see.
Okay. And the interior of the store is basically, there's no seating in the interior of the store. It's all either service areas, restrooms, and or cash registers, correct?
That is correct.
Okay. You can resume your seat over here. Yeah. The prototype, or the store that we're proposing here is a newer prototype of Wawa, is that correct?
Yes, it is.
When have you started constructing this store?
In the past two years.
Okay. And in a report from Mr. Healy dated October 16, 2015, he had provided a photograph of another Wawa store at some other location here in the state of New Jersey. This is your older prototype store?
That is correct. It's outdated.
Okay. Why do you say it's outdated?
At this point, we're moving forward with the new design.
Mm-hmm.
We believe to stay current, relevant within the communities, we've designed this building. And in fact, over the next 4 years, our company is embarking on a remodel program, which these stores, even if they were built 10, 15 years ago, they are being remodeled with our new standards.
And what are the, I mean, again, I know branding is important, but what are the benefits, or why is the store better than your older store as far as functionality design, at least in the company's opinion?
I believe for the access through the front, I mean, with the larger entrance, with the arcade, the doors, we believe that is enhances the customer experience, ability to navigate in, out, through the site.
Okay. Now, does Wawa franchise the stores?
No, sir.
So every store is owned by Wawa?
Yes, it is.
Okay, so any renovations, retrofits will be, you know, if you're doing them, it's to your own stores. Is that correct?
All through corporate.
Okay, and at this site, what are the hours of operation?
24 hours.
Okay, and all the employees then, since Wawa owns the stores, are all company employees. Is that correct?
All associates are company employees.
Okay, can you briefly indicate what Wawa sells?
Sure.
Peter, really?
All right.
Pete, that's bad, Pete.
All right. Let's go back to other, just for the record.
Gas might be one of them.
No, but I mean in the interior.
No, I know.
Just the issue of preparation of food. I just wanted to make sure the board understands there's no cooking of food preparation.
Have I mentioned I like their coffee?
No frying nor grilling.
Okay. Any outside displays of sales or products at the pumps?
No.
Okay. And you don't do any repairs of vehicles, no oil changes, correct?
That is correct.
All right. Can you briefly indicate, because the question of deliveries, how are your products delivered, fuel delivered, groceries delivered, and other products?
Sure. Our groceries are delivered 3 to 4 times a week through the rear. They would be on site for half an hour, 30 minutes. Fuel is once a day at a minimum. And, of course, that is fueled through at the tanks.
Okay. And you also have some outside vendor deliveries?
Yes, we do. Some Enemans, HERS, the newspaper deliveries, they would come through a box truck at the front of the building. They would take up a normal parking space, and they're there for 15, 20 minutes.
Okay. How many employees will you have at this site?
It range from 40 to 50.
Okay. And obviously, there's three shifts. Is that the way it works?
That is correct, sir.
Evening shift, how many employees do you normally have?
Each store is different. It depends, you know, on the location. That could be four to five employees.
All right. I have a lot of other questions about the operation, which I'm not going to want to hear, so I'm not going to ask them. But if the board has any other questions, feel free
yes.
to ask.
4 to 5 employees night?
That would be at the 4 to 5 at night. That would be the minimum for inside, and we would have two associates out at the fuel stations.
And are you going to have security cameras on both sites?
Oh, absolutely, ma'am. We have cameras inside the building mm-hmm. and along mounted to the exterior of the building and along the light poles and along the canopy.
Good.
Does the board have any sort of a design or function type related questions? So that don't forget, every witness still sworn in, so we can always come back if you think of something. All right, let's go with the next one.
Justin.
Do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
If you could state your name, spell your last name, and provide us with your address for the record.
Justin Taylor, T-A-Y-L-O-R. My address is 1904 Main Street, Lake Como, New Jersey.
Awesome.
Mr. Taylor, you're a licensed engineer in the state of New Jersey, specializing in the area of traffic.
Yes, I am.
And you've appeared here in Franklin Township. I don't remember if it was the planning board or zoning board previously.
Yes, I have.
Okay, I would offer his testimony. Yeah. Mr. Taylor, you prepared a rather extensive traffic report dated June 18, 2015, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
All right. Very briefly, the construction of this facility, levels of service on Route 27 or Juliet, are they impacted as a result of this project?
They are not. What we anticipate, because of Wawa is a very pass-by driven type of use, the vehicles are already on the road. They're commuting between work and home, and they would now stop here to get their cup of coffee, get their gas during that trip. What we find is incremental increases in delay, where levels of service D exist out there currently at that intersection on the side streets and A along Route 27, and we anticipate the same levels of service for that those approaches with the increase in traffic.
Okay, and you've heard the testimony of Mr. Whitaker concerning site circulation. You've reviewed this. This site can handle the tractor trailer deliveries of whether it be the food or fuel delivery trucks, and there's full access throughout this site. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. The only other issue I need to touch on, in looking at traffic, are there times that you look at signs on site to see visibility of signs and their appropriateness in given locations?
Yes, we do take a look at that.
Okay, and we had originally shown that or asked for a variance for a 20-foot sign. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And Mr. Healy recommended in his report a 10-foot sign, predominantly a monument sign. Do you have an opinion as to an advantage of the higher sign over the monument sign at this location?
Yes. I have visited the site on several occasions, all coming from the north or east, traveling southbound on Route 27. And as you approach, because the buildings to our east are set up close to the building, you don't really have visibility of the site until you get to that traffic light. So what we're looking at, the other thing is, I drive a Subaru. I'm sitting a little lower to the ground, and stuck behind the minivan, you can't see the sign that would be 10 feet high as you approach that as you approach the driveway. What we are looking to do with the monuments, with the pylon sign, was to elevate it slightly, because we are, again, a price-driven company. When they go out there, people are buying gas based on what the price is. We need to advertise that and have people ready to make the turns or make the maneuver from the left lane into the right lane to be able to exit into the site as quickly as possible. So it's my opinion that by elevating the sign and granting the variance for the extra height, it will improve the safety for vehicles to enter the site.
Thank you. I have no further questions.
So just so I can understand, well, just and for the record, I'm not recommending 10 feet. The ordinance requires 10 feet.
Right.
So just basically what you're saying is it's not a matter of when you're driving down the road at a distance, because you're saying because of the buildings on either side, you can't really see it up until you get really close, right?
From the outside lane, it is you're almost upon the traffic signal before you can see where the sign would be.
Okay. So then you're saying, so then when you're in close proximity, if you have a vehicle in front of you, if it's lower, you can't see the sign if it's too low. And the main thing that you're basically, initially I'm thinking the canopy has Wawa on it. People are going to know it's a Wawa. Give me a break. But then I heard the thing about you said about the gas prices.
Yes. And that's correct. I mean,
are you saying that that's really the main driving force, that people can see as they're coming upon the site, if they're stuck a bit, they can see the gas prices immediately?
I mean, I don't know about you. I price shop for my gas. And Wawa does pretty good about keeping them low. But if there's somebody up the street that's 2 or 3 cents cheaper, I go there. So this, I mean, we really need to advertise. And again, we're on a roadway, four lanes, but two lanes in each direction. And you could be traveling in that left lane, need to make a lane change, and then enter the site. So what we really want to do is grab the visibility and give them as much room to be able to see the sign and the price points to be able to enter.
Okay, and how far from the sign is that distance where you can see it, approximately?
Here?
Roughly, as you're coming upon it. I mean, it's not a quarter mile, it's not a half mile.
You're probably 500 feet if you're in the outside lane. Okay. Maybe a little further if you're in the inside lane, just because of the corner of the building.
Okay. And so based on the distance and the angles, what's the minimum height that it needs to be to achieve that customer visibility?
Honestly, I can't answer that question. I don't have the site triangle, the vertical site triangle. We haven't done those mm-hmm. calculations. What we do find is if we do elevate it a little bit, it does increase the visibility.
Well, my suggestion would be is that you come up with that calculation, and I mean, I think we can deal with everything else, but you're asking for the variance, and you're saying elevate it slightly from 10 feet, you're saying to 8 feet, that's almost twice the amount. I think the board would want to know if you're testifying that you can't see it, well, at what height can you see it? And at what distance? I mean, is it appropriate from you as a traffic engineer that for a safety viewpoint that they need to see it 50 feet, 100 feet, or whatever? I think the board needs that information to make that decision as to what variance to grant.
Yeah.
I mean, I understand you're saying make it 18 feet, make it, but what is that height?
It's just arbitrary. How do we know that 15 feet isn't good enough?
Yeah. Or that 10 feet or 11 yeah. feet, I think we need to know.
Let me ask the question, are there tests that you can run to determine a height that would be appropriate for safety and for visibility at the same time?
Yes, it's something we could look at.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. We just could deal with the sign separately. You can get everything else done. You're here all the time, Pete. You can come back and do the sign in 15 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, yeah, Carl. Sorry. Are you done with the...
I was done with this witness.
Okay, Carl, go ahead.
The Juliet Avenue driveway, is there any reason that it doesn't align with Marshall Street across Marshall Ave, actually, across the...
We, in laying out the site, we were trying to look to allow the left turns out of Marshall Street and ours to operate concurrently, to allow the residents that would be coming from the residential neighborhood to our north up Juliet Avenue to be able to exit without interfering and interacting with the Marshall Street driveway across it.
Marshall's pretty far up from the site. Looks like Quentin is the one directly across.
Marshall is directly opposite Juliet. This right here is what he's speaking towards.
Oh.
And we, by...
Oh, you're seeing that driveway. Sorry. Yeah.
It's a right-of-way. It actually is a street. But what we found was there wasn't too much volume coming this way. Most of the people exiting that street are trying to return to Route 27, whereas we were looking to allow the residents that would be coming from Juliet Avenue and this side from the north to be able to then turn without interacting.
Yeah, Marshall. Isn't that not a real car lot?
No.
But it's...
Yeah. Okay.
It doesn't go all the way through. And
I'm not 100% sure if
Marshall
it's
Street.
It's a public right of way.
It's a public road, but it doesn't go all the way through.
That's true. Yeah. Yes, it is a business across the street.
Yes.
That's correct.
Used car. They use it for parking.
Okay.
It's really a parking lot.
It's
all right.
Have
or not worry
just
about
got
that.
People, empty cars parked in
it. So I have a question. So you're asking for a full movement onto 27. Ultimately, the state has that jurisdiction.
Correct.
I don't know. I assume it's probably doable because there's a light. So traffic at some point is going to stop at Juliet, and you could get out probably. What's your contingency plan in case they, or does it change, in case the state does not make it a full movement and only allows right out?
We'd obviously have to change the... We'd have to sign it, I would assume, and also perhaps change the geometry of it to prohibit, depending what the state requires us to do.
I can speak a little further to that. We had a pre-application meeting with the NJDOT on June 4th to actually discuss the layout of the driveway on Route 27.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point, we discussed whether it be full movement, should turning movements be restricted. And what they thought was, given the proximity of the traffic light, that a full movement driveway was appropriate at that location. So I have full confidence that they'll be granted.
Because
that.
At some point, traffic would, you'd have a break, and you could, if you're making a left, you could at least get out to do that.
That's correct.
Obviously, if you're making a right, there's not as much of an issue. All right. Okay. Any other questions for this witness?
I just comment. I think if I were coming up Somerset Street, I would probably go to the light and turn into Juliet and come in that way rather than fighting the southbound traffic to turn in. I think that's, as you say, getting out, you have a chance when the traffic light at Juliet is red, unless the traffic is backed up to your entrance. But I'm not sure that my feeling is strong enough to forbid a full access driveway there. I'm more saying what I would do.
Yeah, I mean, I think if there wasn't a light that would possibly afford you a break, and for that reason, you know, you probably could make a left into, and without having to go up to Juliet to get in the way you just said, because you would have a break at some point in time. I think ultimately the state has to say so. I don't have a strong feeling about this one because there's a light there. If there wasn't a light, I would start pounding on you to make it one.
And we may have analyzed it differently if there was not a light there.
I'll add my two cents, I guess, whether you want it or not, but sure. I drive that street numerous times every day. There's people, including myself, making left turns out of McDonald's, White Castle, Dunkin' Donuts, Hardee's, Harry Weber sign shop.
Mm-hmm.
I must be missing something. For whatever reason, it doesn't seem as difficult in that particular area as it does in other places. And the other side of that is, for the sign variance, I don't know if this is the cure or not, but I would think that coming from New Brunswick, you don't have, you have virtually no visibility of that building until you get to it. So I would think something is necessary for visibility, whether it's a 20-foot high sign or 18 feet. I think you need to determine that, but I don't see you having a visibility problem going in the other direction toward New Brunswick.
No, not at all. We have very clear sight lines to the south. It's the vertical curve along that as you travel, yes, which is really west, but southbound on Route 27 that creates the issue. That and the proximity of the buildings to our east that are right up on the street.
Would moving the sign closer to the road make it better?
It would improve the sight lines for sure. It would give you greater visibility further east up 27 towards New Brunswick.
Okay.
You still run into the same issue, though, depending on the size of vehicle you're in and the size of vehicle in front of you.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So I guess, you know, you're going to deal with the sign at some other date, but you might want to look into that as well. Because one of the things the board has done in the past is when there has, you've kind of modified, kind of played a little bit with the height versus the setback. You're set back a little bit off of the road already in terms of the right-of-way. So if the sign was to be lower, but maybe a little bit closer to the road, and if that achieved what you needed.
How close to the road can it be without them needing a setback variance?
Well, the setback requirement is 10 feet. Mm. But, you know, if it was made lower, but it's still, you know, good. The right-of-way line is I think it's 10 feet off of the travelway anyway.
15 feet off the travelway.
So already, even if you put it zero setback, it's still 15 feet off the travelway.
We can take a look at.
And if the sign is lower and more in scale.
Yeah, and both boards, both the planning and the zoning board, have consistently approved those type of variances because they wanted to keep the height down, you know, as long as the setback didn't interfere with any sight distance or any traffic issues. I mean, how many times, Bob, you guys have done it at the zoning board, push it up a little bit. If you can make it 5 feet less, typically the boards wanted that.
Yeah, I think that's a trade-off worth exploring.
Well, I mean, for the sake of tonight, pursuant to your ordinance, we are allowed a 10-foot high sign on Juliet. We're allowed a 10-foot high sign on Somerset Street. I would like approval of two conforming signs, which we are allowed, and then we can evaluate everything and then come back. And
well, where are you going to put them, Pete? You need, they're not, you know.
It has to meet the setback requirements, a conforming sign.
Yeah, but you're not sure, you have to tell us where, if they're going to approve the site plan, you need to tell us where in the site the other one's going to be.
Yeah, but why do you want to put one on Juliet? Your need is not any greater than before. No, that's just ridiculous. No, you're not going to get that. We're either going to come back and let us know, because I'm not approving two signs when you're only asking for one, and I'm not approving some arbitrary height. That's ridiculous.
Well, except the two signs are, we have a right to.
You don't have a sign in the site plan in Juliet, so if you want approval tonight with a sign, we'll give you approval for one 10-foot sign, and you can come back and show us where the other one's going to be and also talk about any height.
I will then ask for the approval of the 10-foot sign on Route 27, and then we'll come back for either an amendment to that sign or for a second conforming sign.
That's fine. Okay, let's move on.
The board had two other issues that we were dealing with. One was the screening, I think, that we talked about, and then the design of the building. Both of those are board issues.
Well, they say they could put a fence around whatever, right? Yeah. So why don't you just do the fence so it's screened if you can't do landscaping? And the design, it's a board issue. I don't have a real problem with it. I mean, pitched roofs are what's recommended. We hear testimony that that's not the design of Wawa anymore. I assume the flat roof is also because the parapet screens your mechanical equipment. We had another application where we enforced them with a pitched roof, but to be fair, but I don't have a strong feeling on that. I don't care. I don't know what the rest of the board thinks, but that's just my opinion. Nobody's shooting me down, so that's good. Yes, Ted.
I wanted to know, why does the building look so high? It looks as if it were a two-story building.
They'll tell you. The same reason the CVS's and the Walgreens are like that.
The height of, other yeah. than the tower, first of all, it's well under the height requirements of the zone. Number 22 feet, I believe. 22 and a half feet is to hide the mechanicals behind it. Lori, what's the height of the tower?
Top of peak is 33 feet.
Okay.
It's a marketing. You market it that way, just like the Walgreens, and it meets the ordinance, right? I mean, that's yeah. Well,
okay.
That's what the reason is.
We have to open to the public. You done with witnesses, Pete?
I am done with witnesses.
Okay. Let's open.
Make a move to open to the public.
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone from the public wishing to speak on this application? Going
move
once.
To close to the public.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Oh, let's do a I don't suppose you have any summation other than you probably. I'll make a motion, and then if you've got a problem or whatever, you can let me. So I'll make a motion to approve with the stipulations we talked about tonight. A conforming sign pending potential future investigation of that, but as you know, the one conforming freestanding sign, and with the other variances for where are they?
Technically, the signs on the
the building-mounted sign area and the number of building-mounted signages, those variances, okay. The freestanding sign, just one at 10 feet, conforming. And, I think that's it.
And the design waiver for the building?
The design waiver for the building, you said you'd screen the trash enclosure with the fence, with whatever is wrapping around there. The sidewalks don't really require, well, they do require a design waiver, but that's fine. The refuse design waiver, fine. The screening doesn't require a design waiver. Just to be absolutely 100% conforming here. Indoor and outdoor plaza shall be encouraged. Street furniture, no such areas proposed. It's fine. That design waiver is not an issue. So I think that addresses all.
Second the motion.
Councilman Chase?
Yes.
Mr. Houck?
Yes.
Ms. MacGyver?
Yes.
Mr. Mettler?
Yes.
Mr. Onyaka?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yeah, and I also think it's good that there's going to be 488 more plants when you're done than there are there today.
Chairman Arsini.
It's my line, Bob. Yes.
Good holiday.
You too.
You too, Peter.
Don't run away yet. We need to go into executive session, and I guess first we need a resolution authoring same, right?
Yes.
Authorizing
That's in your packet.
It's in my packet. I'm not going to fish it out again. Make a motion to approve the resolution to go into executive session.
Well, that's actually, you need to.
So moved.
Why don't we make the motion and approve it at the same time?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll make the motion that, what, I thought that's what I did. Well,
you went to approve a resolution memorializing an action you hadn't taken.
Okay.
It's just a technical thing. It's just, yeah.
If the lawyer's in the room, he's going to make you do that. So,
okay.
I'm sorry.
Well, you're the lawyer. Yeah. Okay.
So it'd be a motion to go into executive session as well as to approve the form of resolution taking that action.
Right.
Okay. What he said.
Councilman Chase?
Yes.
Mr. Hawk?
Yes.
Mr. MacGyver?
Yes.
Mr. Mettler?
Yes.
Mr. Onyaka?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Chairman Arsini?
Yes. Okay, motion to adjourn.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.